الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. Today is going to be our first day of the second دورة علمية that we're going to be having بإذن الله الكريم. Today we're going to be starting with the Kitab Usul Sunnah by Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullahu ta'ala. And for a person to study Aqeedah is very important for them. Aqeedah takes precedence over everything. For you to know your creed and what you can believe in and what you can't believe in, it's vital and it's important. The poet, he said, وَبَعْدُ فَالتَّوْحِيدُ عِلْمٌ يَنْبُلُ عَلَى الْعُلُومِ كُلِّهَا وَيَفْضُلُ قَدْ أَوْجَبَ الرَّحْمَانُ مِنْهُ قَدْرًا لَيْسَ يَصِحُّ الدِّينُ حَتَى يُدْرَى. The poet, he said, وَبَعْدُ فَالتَّوْحِيدُ عِلْمٌ يَنْبُلُ. Tawheed and Aqeedah is the most virtuous, the most noble of sciences. عَلَى الْعُلُومِ كُلِّهَا وَيَفْضُلُ. Over every other science, over hadith, over fiqh, over any other science there is out there, Tawheed and Aqeedah takes precedence over it. لَيْسَ يَصِحُّ الدِّينُ حَتَّى يُدْرَى. Your religion is not correct without Aqeedah. So it's important that we start our dawrah with the study of Aqeedah and Tawheed. And who is it better than studying from one of the great imams of this ummah, Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah, who was referred to as Imam Ahli Sunnati wal Jama'ah. I'm quickly going to go over the biography of Al-Imam Ahmad. Even that though Al-Imam Ahmad is a well-known imam, he's from the last of the four imams that are followed in fiqh. The first of them is Abu Hanifa. The second one is Al-Imam Malik. The third one is Al-Imam Shafi'i. And the fourth one is Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullahu ta'ala. Al-Imam Ahmad's name is Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal ibn Hilal al-Adnani al-Shaybani. His name is Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal ibn Hilal al-Adnani al-Shaybani. He's an imam fi al-fiqh. He's an imam in fiqh. Imam fi al-hadith. إمام في الزهد إمام في العقيدة. الإمام أحمد, his kunya was Abu Abdullah, even that though Abdullah wasn't his oldest son. الإمام أحمد was born in Baghdad and he grew up in Baghdad, so he's Baghdadi. And he was born in the month Rabi' al-Awwal, when the year was 164 Hijriah. Al-Imam Ahmad, he grew up seeking knowledge. At his time, the scholars would memorize the Quran first, so he memorized the Quran first. And when he reached the age of 16, he embarked on the first journey to seek knowledge. And he traveled a lot. And one of the travels in which he went through was the travel that he went to by walking on his feet, no riding beast, from Baghdad to Yemen to meet Abdul Razzaq ibn Hammam al-San'ani rahimahullah. And at that time, he didn't have any money, nothing, Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. And so he used to faint on his journey to Yemen. If you want to see the more details of it, go to the kitab Tabaqatul Hanabila by Abu Ya'la. He went through a lot of hardship, physical pain, and his health deteriorated on that journey. And so when he reached Mecca after coming from Yemen, they said to him, "You've struggled yourself, Ahmed. You've caused yourself so much harm and so much pain." And then he responded, he said, "Ma ahwan al-mashaqqa." Easy is the pain. It's nothing hard. فيما استفدنا من عبد الرزاق in comparison to what I benefit from عبد الرزاق. I took from him the hadith of Zuhri عن سالم بن عبد الله عن أبيه. I took that chain of narration from him. And I also took from him the narrations of الزهري عن سعيد بن مسيب عن أبي هريرة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Gold. I got these chains from him. So my journey, there was no problem. The scholars of his time, they praised him excessively. They praised him. And Imam al-Shafi'i asked Ahmad ibn Hanbal to come to him in Egypt. When Imam Shafi'i left Iraq, and he went to, because Ahmad was from the students of Imam al-Shafi'i, right? Shafi'i went to Egypt, and he resided in Egypt. So he requested from him, and he asked him if he could come to him in Egypt. Ahmad said, I have no money and no way to reach you. Nothing, I can't come to you. So it happened that Imam al-Shafi'i came to where? Came to Baghdad for the second time. And when he saw him, Imam al-Shafi'i said, Ya Aba Abdullah, Abu Abdullah, إِذَا صَحَّ الْحَدِيثُ if the hadith is sahih, عِنْدَكَ according to you, فَعَلِمْنِي teach me. A teacher saying to his student, teach me. If the hadith is authentic to you, and I might see it to be weak, teach me, educate me. Let me know if it's ruling. And tell me the hadith, if it's Hijazi, or if it's Shami, or if it's Iraqi, or if it's Yemeni. Tell me, I want to know it. Ibn Kathir, right after mentioning that story, he commented and said something amazing. He said, إِنَّ فِي قَوْلِ الشَّافِعِي in a statement of Imam al-Shafi'i towards Ahmed is لِإِجْلَالًا كَثِيرًا وَشَهَادًا فِي الْعِلْمِ عَظِيمًا. It was honoring and venerating this man and how vast his knowledge was, Imam Ahmed. ولذلك Imam al-Shafi'i, he said, خَرَجْتُ مِنَ الْعِرَاقِ I left Iraq. فَمَا تَرَقْتُ رَجُلًا I have not left a man. أَفْضَلَ وَلَا أَعْلَمَ وَلَا أَرْوَعَ وَلَا أَتْقَى مِنْ أَحْمَدِ بْنِ حَنْبَلٍ I have not left a man more knowledgeable, a man who has more taqwa of Allah Azza wa Jalla than Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. The whole of Iraq, I've only left this man. Something that really touched me was Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, there's a lot of things I can say about him, but his wara' and how he turned away from the dunya and he left it. I'm going to mention two stories to make us understand how these people reached this level of imama in the deen. Allah gave them this position. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, his teacher Shafi'i, they were sitting together one day. Harun al-Rashid and Shafi'i. Harun al-Rashid, you know who he is, right? He's the Khalifa of the Muslims. He's the leader of the Muslims. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i said to Harun al-Rashid, Ya Amir al-Mu'minina, the leader of the believers, إِنَّ الْيَمَنَ يَحْتَاجُ إِلَىٰ قَاضٍ The land of Yemen, they need a qadi. They need a what? They need a qadi. فَقَالَ لَهُ الرَّشِيدُ Harun al-Rashid said to Shafi'i, اِخْتَرْ رَاجُولًا نُوَلِّهِ إِيَّهِ Choose a man and we'll give him the position. Now what we have to understand is, a qadi is the supreme court. His job is considered to be like if wherever he is, he has the highest authority, one of the highest authorities. It's not just a judge in a masjid or something like that. A qadi has a mansib ali, high level. He can make people get arrested. A big position. And the salary that they get is very, very big. So Imam Shafi'i said, Ahmed, because Ahmed ibn Hanbal was there. He said, Ahmed, because Ahmed used to come to Shafi'i so many times to take knowledge from him. He said, Ahmed, you take this. أَلَا تَقْبَلُ قَضَاءَ الْيَمَنِ يَا أَحْمَدُ Ahmed, why don't you take the position? And he said,
إنما أختلف إليك لطلب العلم. شافعي, I only come to you to seek knowledge from you. I'm a person who wants to stay away from the dunya. فتأمرني, are you commanding me? And آتي القضاء, that I take a position and I become this. ولو للعلم, if it wasn't for knowledge that you give me and you're my teacher and you're a person who has knowledge, لما كلمتك بعد اليوم, I would never have spoken to you after today. I would have boycotted you. That was one. فاستحيا منه الشافعي. And Imam al-Shafi'i became very shy, وسكت, and he went quiet. The second was, Imam Ahmad became hungry for 3 days. 3 days he had no food to eat, Imam Ahmad. And a group of people saw Ahmad dizzy on the street, dizzy. Imam Ahmad was dizzy due to hunger. And so what they did was they took yeast and barley and they tried to make bread. When they went to make the bread, they made it in the house of his own son, Imam Ahmed's son's house, Salih. They went to Salih's house and they made the bread from Salih's fire. But they bought everything themselves, but they went to Salih's house and they made the bread. When they made the bread, Ahmed sensed it was made fast, so it was somewhere local. And so he asked them, where did you make the bread? And they said that they made it in Salih's house. And he said, I made a covenant that I will never eat from my son Salih's house, because he's a qadi. He works for the government and he takes salary from the government. I don't want his money. وَكَانَ لَا يَأْكُلُ And Imam Ahmed never used to eat from the house of his own son Salih because of wara. He saw the food and the money of his own son to be questionable. That's the level in which he reached, rahimahullah, in terms of wara. In terms of his patience, if you heard the stories regarding that, hadith wala haraj. Talk about it. It's immense and it's great. Ahmed, rahimahullah, he was lashed 100,000 lashes for his belief, for his staunch position regarding the Qur'an not being created. He took a position that the Qur'an of Allah is not created, and he chose not to give in, rahimahullah. And so when he was tested, and he was put through trials and tribulations because of it, he staunchly stuck to his position, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a. And that great imam, in Islam, they said that he had the biggest janazah that was ever seen. He had the biggest janazah that was ever seen. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. Naam. التمسك بما كان عليه أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم والاقتداء به. The author رحمه الله, he started the Risala, and this book is called أصول السنة. أصول, it's called أصول السنة. What does أصول السنة mean? The word أصول means أساس الشيء. It's the foundation of something. وهو ما يبنى عليه غيره. Usul is whatever ever things are built upon. This house, I mean this masjid, these pillars, and this the ground that we're walking on is the base in which this whole masjid is built upon. That's what the word usul means. That's why Allah said in the Quran, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَلِمَةً طَيِّبَةً كَشَجَرَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ أَصْلُهَا ثَابِتٍ وَفَرْعُهَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. So the word asal is the singular and the plural is usul, the foundations of the sunnah. The word sunnah here has many usages, generally speaking. The word sunnah has many itlaqat, many usages. And the usage of the word sunnah here is, it's the synonym of the word al-aqidah. It's a synonym of what? Al-aqidah. So don't think that the word sunnah here means the opposite of wajib. Oh, it's a sunnah, you don't have to do this. Meaning it's nafila, that it's voluntary. That's not what it means here. Here it means al-aqidah. And the reason why those scholars used to call it sunnah and they chose to use that word sunnah and not the Quran is because there came a group of people who rejected the sunnah, like the Khawarij, who rejected the sunnah. The types of rejection of the sunnah is two types, brothers. The rejections of the sunnah, it comes in two ways. The first one is rad mutlaq, unrestricted rejection. And it was done by the Khawarij. And it was also done by the Rafida, who all rejected the sunnah. And in our time, we find a group who call themselves Zuran wa Buhtanan wa Tadlila, to misguide the people and fool them. They call themselves Qur'aniyun. But they are not Qur'aniyun. They should be called Munkiri as-Sunnah. Because if they followed the Qur'an, then the Qur'an commanded them to follow the Sunnah. So there's a group here now that exists that call themselves, they call themselves Qur'aniyun. They are also rejectors of the Sunnah. And their type of rejection is complete and utter rejection. They reject it in its totality. The second type of rejection is Rad Muqayyad. It's a restricted rejection. Rad Muqayyad, it's a restricted rejection. And that's the rejection that came from the Mu'tazila, and it also comes from the Asha'ira, and it also comes from the Maturidiyya. Their rejection of the Sunnah is partial. It's not complete rejection. They reject it in Aqidah. They reject it in what? In Aqidah. They don't take the Khabarul Ahad, the singular narration, they don't take it in Aqidah. That's a type of rejection. So the scholars like Al-Imam Ahmed and Abu Qasim Hibatullah Al-Lalaka'iyu, and also Qawam al-Sunnah Abu Qasim al-Taymi, and also Al-Imam Al-Barbahari Rahimahullah, and also Al-Imam Ismail ibn Yahya Al-Muzani, and also Abu Bakr ibn Ismail As-Sabuni, and all those imams, they chose to name their books Sunnah because of their rejection of the Sunnah. Does that make sense? And Imam Ahmed started his book by calling it, he started his Usul Sunnah by saying, Usul Sunnati. What does he mean, Usul Sunnah? He means the Aqidah that we hold on to, our foundation that we hold on to. And Imam Ahmed is saying this. Before I start, I want to say a couple of things. Number one, these things that Imam Ahmed is mentioning are fundamental issues. They are not furu'. Keep that in mind, because Ahmed started his kitab by saying, Usul Sunnati indana. So no one can come to us later and say these issues are not fundamental, they are sub-branches, there are differences of opinion. Because Ahmed started by saying they are what? Usul. Okay. Number two, the matters that Ahmed mentions in his book, and generally speaking, the scholars of i'tiqad, in their books, the issues that they mention are issues which are ijma'. There's no difference of opinion. Issues which Ahlul Sunnah agreed upon, they state in their Aqidah books. Are we all together, brothers? The third thing I want to mention is, in this book, there are five issues. And I mentioned these five when I was teaching Sharh Sunnah by Imam Al-Muzani. Sah? What were they? Five fundamental issues. If you remember these five always, and you keep it in your mind always, and you memorize this, it will help you to identify and recognize the deviated groups where they went against Ahlul Sunnah. The first issue is, which all of these five are going to come, and when they come up, I will say to you, this one falls under this issue, this one falls under this issue, this one falls under this issue. I will mention it, inshallah ta'ala. The five is, number one, Masailul Asma'i wa Sifat, Allah's names and attributes. Masailul Asma'i wa Sifat, Allah's names and attributes. There are groups that went against Ahlul Sunnah. Quickly, what are the groups? The first group that went against Ahlul Sunnah in this issue were the Jahmiyyah. And then after them came the Mu'tazila. And then after them came the Asha'ira. And then the Maturidi wa Halumma Jarrah. Are we all together? Maturidi and then Asha'ira. The second is مسائل الأسماء والأحكام. Names and rulings. What do we mean by names and rulings? Like the term Iman, the term Kufr, the term Bid'ah, the term Fisq, the term... Are we all together? These terms, they're names and they have rulings. They are names and they have what? They have implications. If you're a mu'min, you get right from the Muslims. They pray on you when you die, janazah. You can marry a Muslim woman. Rulings come under these names, sah? Groups came and they started to play with these names, like the Khawarij. They started to take some people out of Iman and label them kuffar, and then from there they made their bloods permissible, and then they killed, and then the Mu'tazila came, and then what they said was, we're going to see all of this, that we won't give him the name, we're just going to say manzilatun bayn al-manzilataini, he's between two stations. And the Murji'a who said, no, we're going to give him the name, and even if he does a sin, there's no problem, sins can't harm once you've come with Iman. Those three groups, we'll speak about that when we come indeed. The third issue that went against Ahlul Sunnah, the third issues that you will find in these books of Aqidah is مسائل القضاء والقدر. قضاء and قدر. You're going to see what's the correct position that we have to take regarding the qada and the qadar. The qada and the qadar are the predestined. The things Allah wrote for us that's going to happen to us. Are we going to be from the inhabitants of Jannah? Are we going to be from the inhabitants of the hellfire? How do you reconcile between qadar and free will? We'll speak about that inshallah ta'ala. The fourth issue is al-wa'adu wal-wa'id. مسائل الوعد والوعيد. The person who does a major sin, مرتكب الكبيرة. Allah promises in the Quran, the one that drinks khamar, the one that lies, the one that slanders the Muslim, the Quran mentions that he's going to be in the hellfire. Does that mean he will never enter Jannah? Or does that mean he spends a period of time in the hellfire or not? These promises that we find in the Quran, these warnings that we find in the Quran, how do we deal with them? Groups went against Ahlul Sunnah in this issue. This issue is called Al-Wa'adu Wal-Wa'id. Promises and warnings. Promises and warnings. How do we deal with that? The fifth issue is As-Sahaba. Masail As-Sahaba. Issues relating to what? The companions. How do we deal with the companions? Are the companions infallible? Is Ali ibn Abi Talib infallible? He does no mistakes? Like the Rawafid went overboard with him? Or the Nasibiyah who said Ali is a disbeliever, and the Khawarij who labeled Ali as a disbeliever and made his blood permissible? So groups went against Ahlul Sunnah. These five, you will learn all of the groups that went against Ahlul Sunnah. And this book, it will deal with those five inshaAllah ta'ala. And other issues, extra issues that you need to know. Are we all together, brothers? Pay attention now. Some people will say, why is it that we find in Aqidah books, issues relate, fiqh issues, like wiping over your socks. I'm wiping over leather socks. It's stated in Aqidah books. But this is a fiqh issue. Why was it brought here? This problem has come from the belief that many people believe, which is fiqh, all of it is sub-branches. And Aqidah, all of it is usul, foundation, and that's a mistake. There are within fiqh issues which are usul, foundations. Within fiqh, there are fundamental issues that you can't go against. Like there is in fiqh issues which are sub-branches, and that's the most in fiqh. Fiqh, majority of its issues are what? Sub-branches. They are furu'. Aqeedah also has furu', sub-branches. Hey, naam. And it also has usul. Lakin the usul is the most in aqeedah. Does that make sense? So, the issue of al-mas'h al-khuffain, when it was brought into aqeedah, it became a what? A fiqh issue, which is usul. Fundamental issue of fiqh. Does that make sense? Am I making sense? No. So let's understand that bi-idhnillahi al-kareem. So he started his book, Al-Imam Ahmad, something very powerful. He said, usul al-sunnah indana. The foundations of the sunnah to us is holding on to that which the companions were upon, wal-iqtida'i bihim, and to follow them. Powerful. Islam does not need reinterpretation. It doesn't need anyone to revise the verses and what the Quran means. Alhamdulillah, we follow the understanding of the companions. Allah said in the Quran, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُسْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Allah said, and this is Surah An-Nisa, Ayah 115. Allah says, Surah An-Nisa, Ayah 115. Allah says, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ. Anyone who goes away from the path of the messenger, okay? مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى. After clear-cut guidance comes to you, you take a path other than the path of the messenger. After clear-cut guidance comes to you. Is that it? No. وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And he follows a path other than the path of the believers. Who was the believers when this ayah came down? Huh? The companions, we weren't alive. Now focus with me on the ayah. The ayah says, anyone who follows a path other than the path of the messenger and the path of the believers, the hellfire will be his final abode. That's what the ayah says. You follow the other than the path of the prophets and the believers. Who is the believers that Allah is referring to here? Sahaba tubtida'an. The Sahaba is number one. They're the forefront. So if you follow a path other than the path of the prophet and the Sahabas, the hellfire will be your path. Allah is saying that in the ayah. Clear cut verse. A hadith. Hadith Irbad ibn Sariyah. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ. Any one of you who lives, any one of you who is alive, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ. If you are alive in this world, 1,400 something years ago, the Prophet told us, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يَعِشْ مِنْكُمْ فَسَيَرَى اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. You're going to see many difference of opinions. Difference of opinions. Disagreements. So Sheikh so-and-so on the microphone over there is saying something. Another Sheikh over there is saying something else. Another one over there is saying something else. Another one over there is saying something else. Every group is saying, I am guided, and the other one is misguided. You're going to hear that. Who told us this? The Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. Now look at the solution he gave us. How can we get out of this disputes, this argumentation, these differences? How can we all come together? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, عليكم بسنتي. Upon you is my sunnah. وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ الْمَهْدِيِينَ. And the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and the companions. عَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِدِ. The Messenger said, hold on to it on your molar teeth, not your front teeth. Because if you hold on to it on your front teeth, you might let it go. But if you hold on to it with your molar teeth, you won't let it go. You will hold on to it strong. You will bite onto it. عَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِدِ. Then the Messenger told us, وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَمُحْدَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ. And stay away from the newly invented matters. Things that have been introduced into the religion, stay away from it. Why? Because that's what's going to disunite you. Brothers, in this religion, in this deen, Allah says to the Prophet, فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَكْ. Muhammad, if they don't follow you, Muhammad, فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَكَ فَعْلَمْ أَنَّمَا يَتَّبِعُونَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. Know that they are following their desires. So we only have one of two. Either you're following Allah and His Messenger, or you're following your what? The desires, Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he said, it came in many forms. Some people's desires became logic. That was the Mu'tazila. They opposed the Quran and the Sunnah with their logic. They said that we can't reconcile between the Quran and our logic. That was the Mu'tazila. The Sufiya came and they said, Dhawq. We sense it. Spiritual inspiration. Our hearts, what we feel. That's what they opposed the Quran and the Sunnah with. Another group of people, they opposed the Quran and the Sunnah based on their customs. Our custom and our tradition is not like this. Another group of people opposed the Quran and the Sunnah by our madhab, our imams, they don't say this. Everyone came with their desires in different forms and in different ways. So it's either the Quran or the Sunnah you're following, or you're following your desires. And the desires comes in many different forms. So Al-Imam Ahmed, this great imam, he saw it vital, important, that he starts his book by saying, the foundation of our religion is built upon the path of the companions. Look, brothers, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, مَنْ كَانَ مُسْتَنًا فَلْيَسْتَنَّ بِمَنْ قَدْمَتْ فَإِنَّ الْحَيَّ لَا تُؤْمَنُ عَلَيْهِ الْفِتْنَةِ أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابَ مُحَمَّدٍ أَبَرَّ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ قُلُوبًا وَأَعْمَقُهَا عِلْمًا وَأَقَلُّهَا تَكَلُّفًا اخْتَارَهُمُ اللَّهُ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى لِصُحْبَةِ نَبِيِّهِمْ فَعَرَفُوا لَهُمْ حَقَّهُمْ وَاتَّبَعُوا بِهِمْ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا عَلَىٰ هُدًى مُسْتَقِيمٍ. If you're going to hold on to someone, hold on to the ones who have passed away. For verily the one who is alive, there's no reassurance. He can apostate tomorrow. The person you've been idolizing, the person you've been looking up to, my sheikh, my imam, can turn away. And we've seen the problems that he has when people idolize a living person who's still alive in this world. The person, he's still fi qayd al-haya. He's still living, so he can change. He can leave the religion. Hold on to the ones who are dead. Who are the ones who are dead? Who we know were promised paradise whilst they were alive? Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and their likes. They're the ones who are promised. Hold on to them. Insha'Allah ta'ala, you will find success. Naam. Al-Imam Ahmad then said, وَتَرْكُ الْبِدَعِ. Stay away from innovation. Stay away from innovation. You see, you can't follow the companions and then follow bid'ah. They are two diametrically opposite to one another. What's disuniting the Muslims is innovation. Stay away from it. Innovation is introducing something into this religion which is not from the religion. After the religion has been completed, after the ayah came down, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. After that verse came down, what does that verse say? Today I have completed your religion unto you. I have completed my blessing unto you. And I have become pleased with Islam as your religion. When that verse came down, there is no religion after that for us. That's the religion. That is the deen. Al-Imam Malik said a powerful statement. He said, مَنِ ابْتَدَعَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ بِدْعَةً يَرَاهَا حَسَنًا فَقَدْ زَعَمَ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا خَانَ الرِّسَالَةَ لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يَقُولُ الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا فَمَا لَمْ يَكُنْ يَوْمَئِذٍ دِينًا فَلَا يَكُونُ الْيَوْمَ دِينًا. Al-Imam Malik said, anyone who introduces a matter into the religion which is not from the religion has claimed that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has deceived us. Nabi Muhammad deceived us. That's what you're claiming. How are you claiming it? Because didn't the Prophet say, I've conveyed everything? You are coming and you're saying, no, I have a good action that Allah loves and He's pleased with. So then it's either one of two. Did Nabi Muhammad convey? If he says yes, then you know a path that's going to take us to Jannah that Nabi Muhammad didn't convey to us. If he says he did convey to us now, where did he convey to us? Show us. The innovation, it happens in two places. It happens in your aqeedah, and there are many groups that came, such as the Khawarij, and the Qadariyah, and the Jahmiyyah, and the Mu'tazila, and the Rafidah, and the Mushabbiha, and the Mu'attila, and the Mutasawwifah, and the Jabariyah, and the Murji'ah, and all of these are groups of what? Innovation. They all came. They are creedal innovation, these ones. The second group is those who came with bid'ah in actions. Like celebrating the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, adding things to the prayer, and other actions that people have come with. All of those are innovation. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, alayhi salatu wasalam, man ahdatha fi amrina hadha ma laysa minhu fahuwa rad. Anyone who adds anything into this religion that is not from it, it will be rejected. The Prophet said, "Man amila amala laysa alayhi amruna fahuwa rad." It's rejected. It is turned back to the person's face. It won't be accepted. So stay away from innovation. Naam. The third point that Imam Ahmed mentioned is stay away from argumentation, stay away from disputing, stay away from sitting with the people of innovation. وَالْجُلُوسِ مَعَ أَصْحَابِ الْأَهْوَاءِ. Three things he mentioned. تَرْكُ الْخُصُومَاتِ. Sorry, two things he mentioned. تَرْكُ الْخُصُومَاتِ. Leave off disputations and argumentations. Stay away from it in the religion. Leave it. وَالْجُلُوسِ مَعَ أَصْحَابِ الْأَهْوَاءِ. And stay away from the people of innovation. Stay away from them. Two things. Again, remember, these are fundamental issues of our religion. Ahmed is saying, أصول السنة عندنا. The foundations of our religion. So this argumentations in the religion is prohibited. The second thing that Imam Ahmed mentioned is sitting with the innovators. What does Ahmed mean? Disputations and argumentations. He means the dispute and argumentation where there is no benefit in the religion for it. Is ضَرْبُ الْآيَاتِ بَعْضِهَا عَنْ بَعْضٍ. It's throwing verses at each other where it shows that the Qur'an, as though the Qur'an is contradicting itself. One throws a verse, and the other one throws another verse, and the other one throws another verse, and the other one throws another verse, and then the people start saying, is this the same Qur'an that they're both reading? And then it leaves doubt in the people's hearts. Stay away from it. وَلِذَلِكَ when the messenger saw a group of people arguing at his time, he said, مَا لَكُمْ تَضْرِبُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ. Why is it that you're throwing the book of Allah? Some of it with each other. Why are you throwing the book of Allah at each other? The Prophet said, this is what destroyed the early generation, the early people. The second part, it's sitting with people of innovation. Stay away from sitting with people of innovation because they will throw doubt in your hearts. Allah said in the Quran, وَقَدْ نَزَّلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الْكِتَابِ أَنْ إِذَا سَمِعْتُمْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ يُكْفَرُ بِهَا وَيُسْتَهْزَأُ بِهَا فَلَا تَقْعُدُوا مَعَهُمْ حَتَّى يَخُوضُوا فِي حَدِيثٍ غَيْرِ. Allah says, if you sit in a gathering and a people are disbelieving in Allah, they are mocking the verses of Allah, Allah says, فَلَا تَقْعُدْ مَعَهُمْ. Don't sit with them. حَتَّى يَخُوضُوا فِي حَدِيثٍ غَيْرِهِ. Until they go into another discussion, meaning until they repent. In another ayah, Allah says, وَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ الَّذِينَ يَخُوضُونَ فِي آيَاتِنَا فَعَارِضْ عَنْهُمْ حَتَّى يَخُوضُوا فِي حَدِيثٍ غَيْرِهِ. Same meaning. If you see a people who have no knowledge, they are speaking about matters of the religion with no knowledge, Allah says, فَأَعْرِضْ عَنْهُمْ. Turn away from them. حَتَّى until يَخُوضُوا فِي حَدِيثٍ غَيْرِهِ. Until they come back from the falsehood that they are indulging into. نعم. The word mira, it means ashakku fi deen, doubt in the religion. Don't argue will lead to doubt in the people's hearts. Stay away from it. Allah said in the ayah, فَلَا تُمَارِ فِيهِمْ إِلَّا مِرَاءً ظَاهِرًا. The word mira means, it means ashakku fi deen, doubting the religion. Stay away from it. And don't argue in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Naam. The Shaykh rahimahullah, he says, وَالسُنَّةُ عِنْدَنَا. The sunnah to us is آثَارُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. It is what is transmitted from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the sunnah. Again, how do we know what is sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Who do we go back to? The people of hadith. We go back to the people of hadith, ahlun naql. And we say, did the Prophet say this? Every hadith that we use, two things we have to verify, brothers. Number one, is it authentic? And number two, has it authentic, correctly corrected? Is it correctly? Was the ruling deducted from it? If you bring a hadith, first of all, is it authentic? هل ثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ Is it authentically being transmitted from the messenger? عدول الثقات. And inshallah ta'ala in the dawra we will be taking a kitab called Ikhtisar Ulum al-Hadith, where we will be speaking about how to identify the authentic hadith. The second thing that you need to know when you're using a hadith is if the ruling has been taken out correctly. Are you using the hadith correctly? He also says, وَالسُنَّةُ تَفْسِيرُ الْقُرْآنُ وَهِيَ دَلَائِلُ الْقُرْآنِ. The sunnah, it explains the Qur'an. The sunnah, what does it do? It explains the Qur'an. But the Qur'an doesn't explain the sunnah. Allah says, وَأَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. Muhammad, we have sent the Qur'an on you to explain for them what is in the book, what's in the Qur'an. Then anyone who leaves the sunnah cannot know what's in the Qur'an. Because who's the one who knows the Qur'an? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلَيْسَ فِي السُّنَّةِ قِيَاسٌ. And inside the sunnah there is no qiyas. What does he mean there's no qiyas in the sunnah? Ahmad means لَجْتِهَادَ بِمَوْرِدِ النَّصِ. If there's a textual evidence, then there's no analogy open for you. You only go to qiyas when you have no dalil. There is no qiyas when the sunnah is there. There is no qiyas when there's a dalil there. Qiyas is only resorted to when? عند عدم وجود النص. When there is no textual evidence. That's the only time that you go to the qiyas analogy. Analogy, what does it mean? You all know what analogy means. Qiyas means when you're trying to compare two things. For example, today, people, they take drugs. Is there any dalil in the Quran, the Sunnah that states drugs? No. The Quran and the Sunnah stated alcohol. But we did qiyas from alcohol because alcohol, what does it do to your mind? It intoxicates. So we know the illah and the reason why alcohol was made haram. So we took that illah and we used it, that reasoning of why alcohol was made haram is present in alcohol, is it in drugs? Is it not? So this is qiyas. Because we don't have no dalil, clear cut, nas saying that drugs is haram. But we don't need it. We have something that alcohol and drugs have in common. That is called what? Huh? That's called qiyas. That's called qiyas. Qiyas is only resorted to when there's no dalil. We don't have no dalil that speaks about drugs. Huh? Do we? Naam. The Imam rahimahullah, he said, "ولا تضرب لها الأمثال." Don't give any parables to the Quran. A person says to you, "قال الله تعالى." Allah said this. The Messenger said. You say, "Let me give you an example." Are you going to go to examples when you have a dalil? Because Allah said in the Quran, "فلا تضربوا لله الأمثال إن الله يعلم وأنتم لا تعلمون." You will know the famous story of Abu Huraira and Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas, Abu Huraira told him that do wudu from whatever goes through fire. Anything that's cooked on fire, you have to do wudu from. Because the Prophet said, تَوَضَّأُوا مِمَّا مَسَّتِ النَّارِ. Do wudu from whatever goes through fire. And then Abdullah ibn Abbas, and he said, أَنَا تَوَضَّأُ مِنْ مَا. Do we do wudu from water if it goes through fire? If someone boils water and we drink it, do we do wudu from water? Abu Huraira got angry. He said, فَلَا تَضْرِبُوا لِلَّهِ الْأَمْثَالِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Are we all together? I'm telling you, the Prophet ﷺ has said, and you're trying to go out of that? And Abdullah ibn Abbas came and he said, okay. Are we all together, brothers? In another riwayah, it mentioned Ibn Abbas said, let me give you an example. Let me give you, أضرب لك مثلا, he said, let me give you a parable, an example. And Abu Hurairah said to him, فلا تضرب لله الأمثال. Don't give any parables to Allah. The one who legislated this is more aware of your example. He knows the example better than you. And this is something that they used to try to do, the mushrikeen. Whenever a verse will be brought to them, they will try to get out of it in a logic. They will try to use their logic and they will try to rationalize it. Are we all together? Like what they said to the Prophet ﷺ, they said, ya Muhammad, if we slaughter something, can we eat it? And we say, Bismillah. He said, of course. Because Allah said, whatever you've slaughtered and you've said Bismillah before, you can eat. They said, oh, okay. And what about this animal that dies without no slaughter? And the Prophet ﷺ said, it's haram. You're telling us now that the animal Allah killed, we can't eat, and the one you killed and you slaughtered, we can eat? Are we all together, brothers? So this idea of trying to oppose the Quran and the Sunnah with logic was always present, brothers. And Allah responded to them, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it was responded to them. So don't try to ever do that. وَلَا تُدْرَكُ بِالْعُقُولِ وَلَا الْأَهْوَىٰ إِنَّمَا هُوَ الْإِتِّبَاعُ وَتَرْكِ الْهَوَىٰ. The aql, are we all together? The aql, I want you to understand this. The aql, it has limitation. The aql has limitation. Three things the aql cannot talk about. This is where the aql stops. The aql is a part of us, right? It's part of us, right? Can your eyesight see everything? Can you see everything with your eyes? I'm asking you guys a question. Can you see everything with your eyes? You have a limit of how far you can see, right? Your aql is limited of how far it can work. How is it that you can make your aql unrestricted and you restrict your eyesight and your other parts of your body? Huh? The aql is like a mobile phone. If it has network, it can work. If it doesn't have no network, it can't work. It's like your eyesight. If it doesn't have light, it can't see. The aql, if it doesn't have revelation, it can't see. Now, my eyes can see. My eyesight, can you see? But can you see in the dark? It doesn't work in the dark. My aql, it can't function if the revelation is not showing it the path. Sah? Three things the aql cannot talk about. Number one, the aql cannot talk about the unseen, the ghaybiyat, the day of judgment. And it can't talk about that because the aql is restricted in the natural world that we live in. The aql is based upon the kuffar. Psychiatrists, they've divided thinking and reasoning into three, sah? Induction, deduction, abduction. All three of them are based on observation, what you can see. The aql can't talk about what it can't see. And the unseen are from the things that the aql cannot see, so it can't talk about it. So it's like a mobile phone that's working in a country that it's not got network for. Does that make sense? Number two, the aql cannot talk about detailed matters of guidance. The aql can guide you to the general things like Allah's existence. Like Allah's existence, the aql can tell us that. That Allah exists. It is aqlan, it's that Allah created this universe. Aqlan, it makes sense. And anyone who tries to say that this world came from nothing, something came from nothing, then has illogical absurdity. In simple terms, he is a fool. Something came from nothing. There's a man by the name of Lawrence Krauss. He wrote a book called Nothing from Something. And he's one of the biggest physicists in the world. Billahi alaikum, what people's mind is he playing with? He defines nothing so much it became something. His definition of nothing became something. But he doesn't want to call it something. He wants to call it what? Nothing. One of the heads of biology is Richard Dawkins. He said, this is how his aql works. He's an atheist, he's a militant atheist. He used his aql so much that he said, mild pedophilia is fine, there's no problem with it. Mild pedophilia, there's no problem with it. Are we all together, brothers? Before him, Stephen Hawkins, a man who occupied Isaac Newton, Einstein's seat. They said he had the highest IQ in the entire universe. I don't know how they didn't check my one and others. They said he was the highest. He allowed all of those immoral acts. Because the aql, that's how it works. Wallahi, when you look at them, their aql has become so low that even little children will not accept that. Are we all together? I had students today. I had a class with them in the morning, and I had class with them in the evening a couple of hours later. So I said to my students, they said, oh, Ustad, we saw you in the morning. I said, are you sure you saw me? They said, wallah, Ustad, we saw you. Their face was so real, they believed in it. An atheist will say, prove that you saw me. Ajib. Skepticism. How do you know you saw me? Can you prove that you saw me? Can you give evidence that you saw me? These little kids were like, come on, Ustad, we saw you. Something that the little children will not even question. So, haqiqah, I was reading just the other day, Fakhruddin al-Razi. Fakhruddin al-Razi is considered to be the most smartest Muslim thinker after Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah. High ranked. Fakhruddin al-Razi reached a level that Abu Hamid al-Ghazali couldn't reach, and Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni couldn't reach. Highest level. And his last moments, what I read shocking was that it was narrated that Imam al-Dhahabi mentioned in his Tariq al-Islam that he said, laytani, I wish I didn't busy myself with philosophy. I wish I didn't busy myself with aqliyat, ilm al-kalam. Wabaka buka'an shadeedan, and he cried severely. Fakhruddin al-Razi. And you know what's sad? Fakhruddin al-Razi turned back and he said, I believe in all of these verses that I used to question. I believe in everything. But Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah said, these people were thinkers and they were so into aqliyat and thinking and looking at these issues so much so that when they even wanted to come back to the haq, they didn't even know what the haq was. Do you believe it that Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, all of his life, he never saw Sahih al-Bukhari? Imagine a man who's ranked that high. He did not come across Sahih al-Bukhari until his last moments in his life. As-sahhu kitab ba'da kitabillah. Are we all together, brothers? So, wallahi, brothers, wallahi salaha. There is nothing better for you than to admit and humble yourself and take the Quran and the Sunnah. And to try to say that's dogmatic. And try to belittle the concept of following the Quran and Sunnah. I promise you, you can run if you want to, and you can go as far as you want. Lakin, وَرَبُّكَ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيَخْتَارُ. This aql inside you, and the one who created you. You only have the pixel, the whole picture, you've got a pixel. Allah has the whole picture. You will never be able to, ever, be able to come with anything better for yourself than what the Quran and the Sunnah have stated. Give in to that, inshallah ta'ala. And you will save you a lot of problems in your life. Surrender yourself to Allah Azza wa Jalla and His deen. I was reading a risala, it's called Ara' Fakhruddin al-Razi. The Opinions of Fakhruddin al-Razi. It's a two-volume book, I just finished it. It's written by Zarkan. Muhammad al-Zarkan, he's a bahith, a researcher at this time. And he researched the opinions of Fakhruddin al-Razi. He said, I have not come across, look at this, please ponder on this. He said, I have not come across Fakhruddin al-Razi have one opinion in one issue. Each issue he's got three or two opinions, at least two opinions. He's contradicting himself. One man has multiple opinions. Are we all together, brothers? So today, even if we say that, okay, let's use our aql. Whose aql are we going to use? Because Abu Hamid al-Ghazali in his Kitab al-Irshad went against Fakhruddin al-Razi. Fakhruddin went against his Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni. Abu Ma'ali went against Abu Hamid al-Ghazali. Abu Hamid al-Ghazali went against his teacher Abu Ma'ali al-Juwayni. They all went against each other. So what aqal and mindset and rationality are we going to use? Are we all together? There's nothing better to say al-kitab was-sunnah bi-fahmi salafi salih. Safe. The Quran and the sunnah and how the three generation who Allah promised Jannah, how did they understand? I want to take that. Now. I mentioned two things that the aqal cannot talk about. What was the two things that I mentioned? The ghaybiyat he can't talk about. Hey, what's the second one? Detailed issues of guidance. Naam. The third one is when two parties differ on an issue, the aqal cannot reconcile between them. That's why Allah says, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ أَيْشٍ فَإِنْتَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ. If you dispute one another, فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. If a disputation and argumentation occurs between two parties, the aql cannot reconcile between them. That's not its position. It can't talk. Because the aql will only increase in what? Confusion. It'll increase a third or fourth opinion. The only thing that that can work here is a text. Are we all together, brothers? These three points, Ibn al-Qayyim mentions in Mukhtasar Sawa'iq al-Mursala, Ibn Taymiyyah mentions it in his kitab, Dar'u Ta'arud al-Aql wa al-Naql. So the aql doesn't work in other than those three places. Does that make sense? So it only works in other than those three places. It can function. But in these three places, accept and surrender. وَلِذَلِكَ when these atheists, they say to you, how do you believe in miracles? It goes against natural, the law of natural, the law of gravity, for example, or it goes against the natural law that we see today, that this universe functions and it works. Say, this is not the place of aql to talk about it. لِأَنَّ the issue of mu'jiza, miracles, are from the unseen. Does that make sense? And its brain, you cannot function it, you cannot understand it. So you have to surrender. Nabiullah Muhammad going on a buraq, and going from Baytul Maqdis, all of this in one night, going all up, that your brain can't fathom that, accept it, okay? And it's funny because they say that we don't believe in something unless we see it. Empirical evidence, right? Have to see it. Well, they're lying because they believe in gravity and they can't see it. They believe in many things that they can't see. They agree that there's gravity, okay? And they say we accept gravity. Do they accept it? How they accept it? They cannot till today define gravity. They believe in love. Can anyone see love? Can you see pain? Pain. Somebody slapped you in the face right now and you went, ah. And then the person said, show me that you're going through pain. Sah? Can't prove to you. But everybody believes in it, right? We all believe in love. We all believe in pain, right? We all believe our wives love us, right? Sah? We don't? How we do? We have to believe in that. If somebody said, I want to see it, I want to smell it, I want to taste it, say, A'udhu Billah, I don't know. Sah? Ladahu. So the Shaykh Rahimahullah, he says, وَمِنَ السُنَّةِ اللَّازِمَةِ الَّتِي مَنْ تَرَكَ مِنْهَا خَصْلَةً وَلَمْ يَقْبَلْهَا وَيُؤْمِنْ بِهَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. From the fundamental issues of the sunnah, that is binding upon every one of us to believe. And the one who says, I will not accept it, and he rejects it, and he doesn't believe in it, he's not from the people of the sunnah. However much he claims, لَمْ يَكُنْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. So remember, Ahmed rahimahullah is trying to say these issues, he's going to mention, These are issues that makes you from Ahlul Sunnah. From those issues he mentions is al-Iman bil Qadri khayrihi wa sharrihi. Believing in the Qadr. These are fundamental issues. It's a fundamental issue from the issues of the religion. And it is one of the articles of faith to believe in the Qadr, the good of it and the bad. And the evidence for that is the hadith which Al-Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih, and Muslim was alone in narrating this, that two noble tabi'een, Humayd ibn Abd al-Rahman al-Himyari and Yahya ibn Ya'mar. Humayd ibn Abd al-Rahman al-Himyari and Yahya ibn Ya'mar. Both of them, they went Hajjaini or Mu'tamiraini, whether it was Hajj or not, the narrator was in a state of doubt. So they said to each other, if only Allah gives us the ability to meet one of the companions from the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. فَوُفِّقَ لَنَا عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ عُمَرٍ. They went to the Kaaba and they saw Abdullah ibn Umar. And so when they went to Abdullah ibn Umar and they told him, إِنَّهُ قَدْ ظَهَرَ فِي قِبَلِنَا. A people have come from our place. Where? Iraq. Especially Basra. A group of people have emerged from within us. These people, يتقفرون العلم. They seek knowledge. They're people who study knowledge, who attain knowledge. And then they started to go into their affairs. But they don't believe in the Qadr. Abdullah ibn Umar, and he said, فَأَخْبِرْهُمْ أَنِّي بَرِيءٌ مِّنْهُمْ. Tell them that I am free from them. وَأَنَّهُمْ بُرَآءٌ مِّنِّي. And that they are free from me. We're free from each other. حَتَّى يُؤْمِنَ بِالْقَدَرِ. Until they believe in the Qadr. Or he said, I am free from them and they are free from me. And then Abdullah ibn Umar saw by Allah, وَاللَّهِ لَوْ أَنفَقَ أَحَدِهِمْ مِثْلَ أُحُدٍ ذَهَبًا مَا قَبِلَ اللَّهُ مِّنْهُمْ حَتَّى يُؤْمِنَ بِالْقَدَرِ. If one of them gave the mountain of Uhud of gold, Allah will not accept it from them until they believe in the Qadr, the good and the evil. And then he said, سَمِعْتُ أَبِي. I heard my father, يَقُولُ سَيْ بَيْنَمَا نَحْنُ جُلُوسٌ عِنْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ ذَاتَ يَوْمٍ اطَّلَعَ عَلَيْنَا رَجُلٌ شَدِيدُ بَيَاطِ الثِّيَابِ شَدِيدُ سَوَادِ الشَّعْرِ لَا يُرَى عَلَيْهِ أَثَرُ السَّفَرِ وَلَا يَعْرِفُهُ مِنَّا أَحَدٌ حَتَّى جَلَسَ إِلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فأسند ركبتيه إلى ركبتي ووضع كفي على فخذي وقال يا محمد أخبرني عن الإسلام. And then the Prophet told him the five pillars of Islam, and then he asked him about al-Iman, and then the Prophet told him about al-Iman, which was what? أن تؤمن بالقدر. From the six was what? أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتب ورسله واليوم الآخر وتؤمن بالقدر خيره وشره. So believing in the Qadr is one of the articles of faith. Point number two. So the first point I mentioned was al-Imanu bil Qadri khayrihi wa sharri ruknun min arkan al-Islam. Ruknun min arkan al-Iman. It's a pillar from the pillars of al-Iman. Point number two. The evil that's attributed to Allah is not pure evil. What do we say? أَنْتُؤْمِنَ بِالْقَدَرِ خَيْرِهِ وَشَرِهِ. The Qadr doesn't have pure evil in it. It's like fire. Fire, if it cooks food for you, it's good. And the fire can also burn someone, and it's what? It's bad. صح? True or false? But is the fire bad? Is the fire bad? No. It's bad when it comes into contact of something it should not come into contact with. But the fire is not bad in and within itself. Is it? Huh? So the Qadr is not bad in and within itself. Everything which you see evil in it, there's khayr in it for you. Are you with me? وَلِذَلِكَ. Point number three. We never attribute the evil to Allah. ولذلك the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? وَالشَّرُّ لَيْسَ إِلَيْكَ, and the evil is not to you. I mean, it's not from you. صح? The evil is not from you, O Allah. Nabiullah Ibrahim, what did he say? وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَوَيَشْفِينَ, if I become sick, sickness, who did he attribute it to? Himself. But the food and the provision, وَهُوَ الَّذِي يُطْعِمُنِي, Allah is the one who gives me provision. Allah is the one who guides me. All of that, who did he attribute it to? Allah. But the sickness, who did he attribute it to? Himself. Khadir. Khadir, you all know Khadir, right? Khadir, when he punched a hole into the boat, who did he attribute the breaking of the boat? When he made a hole in it. وَأَمَّا السَّفِينَةُ فَكَانَتْ لِمَسَاكِينَ فِي الْبَحْرِ فَأَرَدْتُ أَنْ أَعِيبَهَا, I wanted to fault it. صح? So the faulting of the boat, which wasn't something that looks good from the apparent, even though the good was intended from it, he attributed it to himself. But what about when it came? Jidaran, the house that he built. فَأَرَادَ رَبُّكَ أَنْ يَبْلُغَ أَشُدَّهُمَا, when it came to building the house that collapsed, and he wanted to cover for them their treasures, he said, فَأَرَادَ رَبُّكَ, your Lord, Allah intended. The building, he attributed to Allah. The breaking of the boat, he attributed to himself. And this is the akhlaq that a Muslim has towards Allah Azza wa Jalla. That we don't attribute to Allah the evil that happened to us. Who do we attribute it to? Ourselves. وَلِذَٰلِكَ, when you flick through the news and you see what's happening in the Muslim world and people suffering, it is not bad to say this is our own sins. This is what we've done to ourselves. وَمَا رَبُّكَ بِظَلَّامِ الْعَبِيدِ, Allah is not the oppressor to His creation. Because if you don't say that, and you choose to ignore that, then you've got the other option, which is what? Allah is oppressing the creation. Are we all together? One of two. It's your fault, or it's Allah's fault. Are we all together, brothers? So the Muslims are suffering because of us. We did this to ourselves. Are you all with me? When the Sahabas in the battlefield, they looked around. Who was with them in the battlefield? Nabi Muhammad. Who are these people? The companions of the Allah Azza wa Jalla. And they lost in the battle of Badr. What did Allah say to them? أَوَلَمَّا أَصَابَتْكُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَدْ أَصَبْتُمْ مِثْلَيْهَا قُلْتُمْ أَنَّا هَذَا قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ. You said, who is this from? Why are we losing? Allah said, هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ. It's from you. You did this to yourselves. Who is saying that? Allah is saying, أَوَلَمَّا أَصَابَتْكُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ, when you were afflicted with the calamities, أَوَلَمَّا أَصَابَتْكُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَدْ أَصَبْتُمْ مِثْلَيْهَا قُلْتُمْ, you all said, أَنَّا هَذَا, where has this come to us from? Nabiullah Muhammad is our leader. We are the companions of the messenger. We are fighting with non-Muslims. How could we lose? When you said that to yourselves, Allah said, قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ, this loss has only come to you from your own selves. How? مِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُرِيدُ الدُّنْيَا وَمِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُرِيدُ الْآخِرَةِ ثُمَّ صَرَفَكُمْ عَنْهُمْ لِيَبْتَلِيَكُمْ. Some of you came down from the mountain when you were told to stay on that mountain. And then Allah said, you wanted the dunya, that's why you came down. You wanted the spoils of war. مِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُرِيدُ الدُّنْيَا وَمِنْكُمْ مَنْ يُرِيدُ الْآخِرَةِ. When you went against Allah's command, that's when the calamity came. Imagine, think about this. Sahabatu Rasulillah, they only went this issue one time in the middle of the battle, and there was a consequences. Imagine, kullu lahza, every second, the disobedience that we are doing, we are committing, I myself included, that we're doing every day. Do you think this is going to go without no consequences? Yeah? You think it's going to go without no consequences? No, it has consequences. And then you turn around and you say, why am I suffering for? Why am I going through what I'm going through? And then you want to attribute all the evil to Allah Azza wa Jalla. That goes against tariqatul anbiya, the way of the prophets. Nabiullah Muhammad didn't, he said, evil is not from you, O Allah. Nabiullah Musa Ibrahim, he was attributing the sickness to who? Himself. Khadir, the prophet of Allah, Khadir. Khadir is a prophet from Allah. How do we know he's a prophet? Because in the ayah, وَمَا فَعَلْتُ عَنْ أَمْرِي, I did not do this for my own self, meaning Allah sent revelation on me. Are we all together? All these prophets, they were attributing the wrong to themselves. And they were not attributing it to who? They were not attributing it to Allah Azza wa Jalla. So we have to believe in the qadr, the good of it and the what? We believe in it, we accept it, that everything is written for us. كلها The Imam, Al-Imam Muhammad rahimahullah, he goes into the issue of Al-Iman bil-Ru'ya, believing that Allah will be seen the Day of Judgment. بِأَنَّ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ يَرَوْنَ, that the people will see their Lord the Day of Judgment. But where are they going to see Allah? In Jannah. That is affirmed. This is ثَابِتٌ وَرَدَتْ فِيهِ الْأَحَادِيثِ. It's affirmed and there are ahadith for it. Allah will be seen the Day of Judgment. The ayah 26, Ayah 26, Surah Yunus. Surah Yunus, Ayah 26. Allah said, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُ الْحُسْنَى وَزِيَادَ. لِلَّذِينَ, the ones who have done good, they have Jannah. And they have Ziyada, extra. The ones who have done good, the excellent creation of Allah, they will attain Jannah, وَزِيَادَ, and extra. What does the Ziyada mean? Nabiullah Muhammad explained it. The Prophet done tafsir of that ayah. He said, ziyada means ru'yatullah, Allah being seen the Day of Judgment. It means to see Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, the believers to see their Lord the Day of Judgment. It's found in Sahih Muslim on the authority of Suhayb bin radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So the believers are going to see Allah the Day of Judgment. Allah said in another ayah, وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة. Ayah 22 to 23, Surah Al-Qiyamah. وجوه يومئذ ناظرة. Faces are going to glow that day. Faces are going to glow that day. إلى ربها ناظرة. And those faces are going to look at their Lord, Allah Azza wa Jalla. They're going to look at their Lord. That's the second dalil. The third dalil is, إِنَّكُمْ سَتَرَوْنَ رَبَّكُمْ, you will see your Lord the Day of Judgment. The Prophet said, إِنَّكُمْ, Muslims, believers, إِنَّكُمْ سَتَرَوْنَ رَبَّكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كَمَا تَرَوْنَ الْقَمَرَةَ كَمَا تَرَوْنَ الْقَمَرَ لَا تُضَامُونَ فِي رُؤْيَتِهِ. The Prophet said, إِنَّكُمْ, you will, سَتَرَوْنَ رَبَّكُمْ, you will see your Lord the Day of Judgment. كَمَا تَرَوْنَ الْقَمَرَ, the way you see the moon, لا تضامون في رؤيتي. Can anything cloud the moon from you? No, you can see a full moon. That's the way you're going to see Allah Azza wa Jalla. The scholars, they say that the hadith is not comparing Allah to the moon. It's comparing the seeing with this seeing. التشبيه الرؤية بالرؤية لا تشبيه المخلوق بالخالق. It is comparing the way that you can see this full moon, clear, crystal clear. That's the same way you're going to see Allah Azza wa Jalla the Day of Judgment. No ambiguity, clear. That's how the believers are going to see their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a group of people who rejected the seeing of Allah Azza wa Jalla the Day of Judgment. And that's why Imam Muhammad is trying to reject their argument. And he's saying, don't argue. Don't dispute with this. These are textual evidences. Allah will be seen the Day of Judgment. Azza wa Jalla. They said, لا تدركه الأبصار وهو يدرك الأبصار. They brought that verse. لا يدركه الأبصار. Eyes cannot encompass Allah Azza wa Jalla. How can you guys say Allah will be seen the Day of Judgment? The scholars, they responded and they said, did we say that Allah will be encompassed in the sea? Did we see that Allah will be encompassed in the sea? No, we didn't. The ayah that you brought, it's saying Allah will not fully be comprehended. And we believe that. That Allah will fully not be comprehended, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that doesn't negate that the believer will see who? They'll see Allah Azza wa Jalla. Are we all together? Naam. Ahlu Sunnati wal Jama'a, the issue that they had with the deviant groups, it came from the issue of Allah's speech. وَلِذَلِكَ the Asha'ira, the Mu'tazila, the Maturidiyya. What are they all called together? What are they all called together? Ahlul Kalam. Why are they called Ahlul Kalam? Because the first argument was Allah's speech. Remember that. The reason why they were called Ahlul Kalam, and you will always hear that, Ahlul Kalam. The reason why they were called Ahlul Kalam is because the first khilaf, the first dispute was regarding the speech of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Are we all together? Are you all with me, brothers? So they said, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, I don't want to go into bringing their doubts to you, but what you have to know is Allah, His Kalam is... See, Allah's characteristics are divided into two. Sifat, which are known as sifat dhatiyah, and sifat, which are known as sifat fi'liyah. Sifat dhatiyah and sifat fi'liyah. Are we all together, brothers? What does sifat dhatiyah mean? Sifat dhatiyah are sifat la yanfakku anillahi ta'ala. It's always connected to Allah. It never disconnects from Allah. Are we all together, brothers? Am I making sense? There are characteristics with Allah that never detached itself from Allah. Like Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is always hay. This is sifat dhatiyah. Allah is always sami'. Allah is always basir. He can always hear us and He can always see us. Are we all together, brothers? Am I making sense? Yes, no? And there are other characteristics which are called sifat fi'liyah. Sifat fi'liyah. Sifat fi'liyah is connected to Allah's mashi'ah. He does it when He wants, and He doesn't do it whenever He doesn't want to. Are we all together? Such as sifatul nuzul, Allah descending, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah descends, as we're going to see, inshallah ta'ala, and that's the belief of Ahl Sunnah. Yanzilullah, Allah descends fi thuluthu layli al-akhir, the last third of the night. How does He descend? We don't know. We accept it. We don't know how, lakin. And just because we affirm that Allah descends, that doesn't mean we're saying that He's descending is like the creation. No. Are we all together? The same way that when we say Allah can see and Allah can hear, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I shouldn't have put my hand on my ear when I said Allah can hear. And Allah can see and Allah can hear both, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't mean that we're saying Allah is hearing and seeing is like the creation. Are we all together, brothers? No. He's hearing and he's seeing, it's in a way that befits His majesty. We don't know, but we accept it. Are we all together, brothers? So, you all understand what sifat dhatiyah means, right? You all understand what sifat fi'liyah means, right? Question here is, sifat dhatiyah means sifat which are connected to Allah's dhat, meaning لا يفكوا عن الله تعالى, it never detaches itself from Allah. Sifat fi'liyah, lakin, it's connected to Allah's will. He does it when He wants, and He doesn't do when He doesn't want to. It's connected to His will. Now we come to the issue of Al-Kalam. Scholars, they said that the kalam is sifa dhati and sifa fi'liya. Both of them same time. Are we all together, brothers? How is that? We'll take that in some technical way. Not now. This kitab, we want to have to finish it quickly. Lakin Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, his speech is sifa fi'liya and it's also sifa dhatiya. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are we all together, brothers? From the speech of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is what? Ahlul Sunnah believe Allah tabarak wa ta'ala speaks. Ahlul Sunnah believe that. And they believe Allah's speech, it has words and it has sound. Because of the hadith. Words, sawtun wa harfun. The Mu'tazila, which are a group, they rejected sifatul kalam. They say Allah doesn't even speak at all. Am I making sense, brothers? So then the people said, what about this Quran that we have? Is it not the speech of Allah? They said, no, it's created. That's how they got out of it. Does that make sense now? That's what Imam Muhammad was in prison for. The whole issue of saying that the Quran is created goes back to the characteristics of speech that they don't want to affirm. Ahmed got lashed, he got beaten for this issue. So it's not a trivial issue. It's a serious issue. Are we all together, brothers? Point number two. The Asha'ira came and they said, Allah speaks. We're not Mu'tazila. We don't believe what the Mu'tazila believe. We believe Allah speaks. So they came closer than the Mu'tazila. True or false? Of course, because they accepted the speech. But they said that the speech of Allah is sifa qa'imatun fi dhati Allah ta'ala. It's inside Allah, it doesn't come out. It has no sawt or harf. Am I making sense now? The speech is within Allah. Are we all together, brothers? And it doesn't come out of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Again, this Quran, how did we get it then? Are we all together, brothers? They came with a qa'ida known as the Quran, the speech, the Quran is ibaratun an kalamillahi azza wa jalla. They broke into two groups. Wallahi, I'm not joking. You can research even more, you'll find this. They said that it is the speech of Jibreel, the Quran. A group of the Asha'ira believe that. Another strand of the Asha'ira believe this is the speech of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The meaning is from Allah, the wording is the Prophet's. Are we all together, brothers? A third group of them believe it was created on the trees and Allah put it there and they took it from the wahakada. That's sahih. They believe that. Are we all together, brothers? Bring it back. Asha'ira finally have to fall into the belief of the Mu'tazila, which is that the Quran is makhluq. So they become Jahmiyyah. The Asha'ira of today, they have to become Jahmiyyah in their belief. Are we all together, brothers? Ahlul Sunnah said, Wallahi, the Quran is the kalam of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Laysa bi makhluqin, it's not created. One of the ways Ahlul Sunnah argued with the Asha'ira, because the Asha'ira are the ones who claim Ahlul Sunnah. They said, okay, they said the speech is within Allah. Okay, stop. Nabiullah Zakariya, are you all paying attention? I want you to think with me. I don't want to go into detail. I'm avoiding details. I'm trying to mention it simple. Nabiullah Zakariya, and Allah gave him the glad tidings that he's going to have a child. What did he say? Qala Rabbi ja'ali aya. Oh Allah, I want a sign that my wife is pregnant. She's going to have a child. I want a sign. Qala ayatuka, the sign that you're going to be given is that you can't talk for 3 days. Illa ramza. You can only do signs. Pay attention. Please. I'm moving forward. I want you guys to focus with me. Qala ayatuka alla tukallima an-nas. Your sign is that you won't speak to the people. Nothing will come out. It will be inside you. According to the Asha'ira, Allah couldn't have said, قَالَ آيَتُكَ أَلَّا تُكَلِّمَ النَّاسِ, because the kalam to them is something that's within you, that doesn't come out. Am I making sense? According to the Asha'ira, he speaks. Zakariya speaking. قال آيتك ألا تكلم الناس ثلاثة إلا رمزا. To do marks and Zakariya, Allah made him mute. He couldn't talk. If he wanted to, he couldn't talk. So Allah said, you're not going to talk. According to that Sha'ira, that's speech still. Because speech is what doesn't come out. Does that make sense? Am I making sense here? Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah brought that point out against that Sha'ira. He said, what do you say in this ayah? Allah said in another ayah, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. That if a non-Muslim comes to you, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala said, give him shelter and make him hear the speech of Allah, كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. Allah referred to the Qur'an as a what? كَلَامَ اللَّهِ. Okay, Asha'ira were grabbed again. How do you say Allah doesn't speak? When Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He spoke to Nabiullah Musa, وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Allah spoke to Nabiullah Musa. When Allah spoke to him, how did he speak to him? In the valley, remember. يَا مُوسَى وَأَنَا اخْتَرْتُكَ فَاسْتَمِعْنِي مَا يُوحَى إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَاعْبُدْنِي وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. Allah تبارك وتعالى said, إِنَّكَ بِالْوَادِ الْمُقَدَّسِ طُوَى. You are in a blessed valley. Take off your shoes. Nabiullah Musa took his shoes off. Asha'ira, Allah is speaking and Musa is hearing something, so there's harfun wa sawt. You know what they said? They said, it wasn't Allah who spoke. And who spoke? The tree spoke. Then Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah said, how can the tree say, إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُنِي وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي. How can the tree say, إِنَّنِي أَنَا اللَّهُ, I am Ilah, worship me. Are you with me, brothers? All of this is ghurub. It's trying to run away that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala talks and not affirming it. Are we all together, brothers? Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah believe Allah speaks and this Quran is the speech of Allah Azza wa Jalla. We don't believe it's created. It's not makhluq. It is not created. And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala's speech is not created. It's His characteristic, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'am. This is again, he's talking about the issue of Allah being seen the day of judgment. Allah will be seen the day of judgment. Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah believe that. And he will be seen in Jannah as he wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the hadith are authentic regarding this. And وَلَا عِبْرَةَ بِمَنْ أَنْكَرَ ذَلِكَ. We give no consideration to anyone who rejects it. These ahadith are authentic to us and they're in the books of hadith, Bukhari and Muslim and others. Na'am. Al-Imam Ahmed, this mas'ala, we can look at it from two angles. One angle, if we look at it, it becomes a mas'ala khilafiyya. Another angle, if we look at it, it's not a mas'ala khilafiyya. One way, if we look at it, which is, did the Prophet ﷺ see Allah Azza wa Jalla the night of Isra wal Mi'raj? There's a dispute. Of some scholars mentioned that seeing Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that night, some of the scholars, they affirmed it, that he said the Prophet saw Allah. وَأَوَ قَوْلٌ ضَعِيفٌ. It's a view that's weak. Lakin, best way to reconcile between the two views is that there isn't two views, there's only one view, which is the ones who said the Prophet ﷺ saw Allah, they are talking about رُؤْيَ قَلْبِيَّ. رُؤْيَ قَلْبِيَّ, which is, can Allah be seen in a dream? Can Allah be seen in a dream? The Prophet ﷺ said, رَأَيْتُ رَبِّي فِي الْمَنَامِ. I saw my Lord in a dream. Hadith sahih. The Prophet ﷺ, he said that. So seeing Allah in a dream, ثَبَتَ عَنِ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. It has been transmitted from the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. أَمَّا رُؤْيَةُ الْعَيْنِ. Seeing Allah with your eyes, لا. Because the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, It says, and then النبي رأى ربه قلبية. In his heart he saw his Lord. Not literally. Because he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, when he was asked, أرأيت ربك, did you see your Lord? And he said, نور أن أراه. Light, how can I see him? نور أن أراه. And another evidence to say that Allah cannot be seen in this world is Nabi Musa. What did Allah say to him? قال لن تراني ولكن انظر إلى الجبل فإن استقر مكانه فسوف تراني. لن تراني, you will never see me. That never is referring to the dunya, not the akhirah. No one is going to see me in this dunya. So no one saw Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in the dunya. Because Nabi Musa asked, Rabbi arini anzur ilayka. Oh Allah, let me see you. Allah said to him, قال لن تراني, you're not gonna see me in this dunya. لن تراني ولكن انظر إلى الجبل فإن استقر مكانه فسوف تراني. If the mountain stays in its position, you're gonna see me. And then Allah تبارك وتعالى, he put out some light, سبحانه وتعالى, and then the whole entire mountain. فلما تجلى ربه للجبل جعله دكا وخر موسى صعيقا. The whole mountain crumbled and Nabi like Musa, he fainted. So he didn't see Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. So it's in a dream or in his heart. Na'am. Jazakallah khair. From the usul of Ahlul Sunnati regarding the Day of Judgment is that we believe in the mizan. Allah said in the Quran, وَنَضَعُ الْمَوَازِينَ الْقِسْطَ لِيَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ فَلَا تُظْلَمُ نَفْسٌ شَيْئًا وَإِنْ كَانَ مِثْقَالَ حَبَّةٍ مِّنْ خَرْدَلٍ أَتَيْنَا بِهَا وَكَفَى بِنَا حَاسِبِينَ. Allah says, we're going to bring the scale that day. وَنَضَعُ الْمَوَازِينَ الْقِسْطَ, the scale of righteous deeds. The scale will be brought. The question here is regarding this scale, what is it that's going to be weighed? What is going to be weighed on the scale? What is going to be put on the scale? One, there are many things that are scaled. Number one, the slave himself is scaled. You, the person himself, will be scaled the Day of Judgment. Are you with me, brothers? And the evidence for the person himself being taken and put on the scale is two evidences. The first one is the hadith that the Shaykh Imam Ahmed brought. يُوزَنُ الْعَبْدُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. A slave will be taken and he will be put on the scale the Day of Judgment. فَلَا يَزِنُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ جَنَاحَ بَعُوضَةِ. And he does not weigh the wing of a mosquito. Another narration mentions, رَجُلٌ سَمِينٌ بَدِينٌ. This man is big, he's chubby, he's fat, and he's going to be put on the scale. And he's not even the weight of a mosquito. Nothing. He doesn't weigh anything. Another evidence for that is قوله تعالى فلا نقيم لهم يوم القيامة وزنا. فلا نقيم لهم يوم القيامة وزنا is that the people, they won't weigh anything that Day of Judgment, the disbelievers. Surah Al-Kahf, ayah 105. The second one is al-a'mal, the people's actions. How would our actions be scaled? It will be given a body. It will be given a physical body and then it will be placed on the scale. And the salah, the dhikr, the things that you used to do, it will be scaled, it will be weighed. Are you with me? The third one is the scrolls. As-suhuf allati tuktabu fiha al-a'mal. The scrolls in which the actions were written on. It will be weighed. And that's the ayah. فَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ وَمَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ. Pay attention here. فَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ, the one who is scale becomes heavy that day, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ, they are the successful ones, brothers. That day, the true muflih, the true successful person that day is the one whose scale is heavy. وَمَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُ, the one whose scale is light that day, فَأُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ, Those are the ones who have destroyed themselves. Those are the lost ones. Those are the ones that are nothing that day. You will know the hadith, يَأْتِي رَجُلٌ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. A man will come the day of judgment with what? Sins. On those sins, he will come with sins that are filling up 99 sijilla, 99 scrolls. كُلُّ سِجِلَّ. Every single scroll is as big as مَدَّ الْبَصَرِ, how far your eyes can see. Abi Hamza al-Kinani, he has a hadith called Juz'u Hadith Bitaqa. Juz'u Hadith Bitaqa. When he read this hadith, Hadith Bitaqa, in the Jama', and he stood over it and he explained it, he cried so much that he had a heart attack and he died from it. This hadith that I'm reading right now. 99 sijilla, 99 scrolls. Each scroll is as full of sin as far as your eyes can see. And then there comes a card. There comes a card. On it is La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Kalimat Tawheed is on there. The slave says, what is that going to do with all of my sins? What is this going to do to all of my sins? فَيُوضَعُ فِي الْمِيزَانِ. It will be then placed on the scale, that card that has La ilaha illallah on there. He was a muwahid. All of the sins he did, كَانَ لَا يُشْرِكُ بِاللَّهِ. He never done shirk with Allah Azza wa Jalla. He never associated partners with Allah. A muwahid. But he's full of sins. Alcohol, zina, riba, every sins. One card, La ilaha illallah. His aqeedah was sahih. No corrupt aqeedah. That card is taken, and he says, what is this going to do compared to all of this? And then it will be said to him, don't worry, today no one is going to be oppressed. Any good that you do will be brought. Any good that you do will be brought that day. And the card will be taken, and then it will be placed on the scale. It will be placed on the other side of the scale. And then the card will outweigh the 99 scrolls of sins. And he will enter Jannah. Sinner, a criminal this man was. What saved him? I'm asking you guys a question, a powerful question. What saved him was Tawheed. La ilaha illallah is what saved him. I urge you all brothers, wallahi I urge you, study this word, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Study it deeply. Don't let it in any way, shape or form become something you go against Allah with. Because if you do, you are corrupt. Naam. This hadith tells, the 19th point. And Imam Ahmad says, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يُكَلِّمُ الْعِبَادَ. Allah will speak to the creation the day of judgment. لَيْسَ بَيْنَهُمْ وَبَيْنَهُ تُرْجُمَانِ. Between Allah and the creation, there is no lawyer. There's no translator. No. وَالْإِيمَانُ بِهِ وَالْتَصْدِيقُ بِهِ. You have to believe in this. This is taken from the hadith of Sahih Bukhari. من حديث عدي بن حاتم, where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, ما من عبد, there is not a slave, إلا سيكلمه ربه. Allah will call, speak to him that day. ليس بينه وبين الله ترجمان. Between you and Allah, there is no ترجمان. There's no lawyer between you and Allah. You'll be questioned and interrogated that day. نعم. We believe in the fountain, the hawd. وَأَنَّ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ حَوْضًا. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم has this. It was a fountain Allah gave him. يوم القيامة, the day of judgment. تَرِدُ عَلَيْهِ أُمَّتَهُ. تَرِدُ عَلَيْهِ أُمَّتُهُ. His whole ummah will come to it. This hawd, عَرْضُهُ مِثْلَ طُولِهِ مَسِيرَةُ شَهْرٍ. The width of this fountain is the distance of a month. 1 month. And yet too, the vessels are ka'adadi nujum al-sama. It's like the stars in the sky. Beautiful, shining, glowing, large in number. عَلَى مَا صَحَّتْ بِهِ الْأَخْبَارُ مِنْ غَيْرِ وَجْهٍ. Authentic narrations have come regarding that. There's a hadith Sahih Muslim in Hadith Abi Dharr that mentions this. Hadith Sahih Muslim in Hadith Abi Dharr. It clearly and categorically mentions that. Who are the people who are going to be stopped from it? Who are the people who are going to be told you can't go? That day when the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam standing there and his nation, the Ummah will come. And then a group of the people, يُذَادُ, they will be pushed away. كَمَا يُذَادُ الْبَعِيرُ الضَّالَّةِ. A group of people will be pushed away, just like a goat or a cow or a camel when it goes into a land that isn't its land. What does the person who owns the land do? He goes, shoo, shoo, this is not your place. A group of people, they will be shooed away from the fountain of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then the Messenger said, I will say to the one who is trying to shoo the people away, I will say to him, Ummati, Ummati, my Ummah, they're my people. Why are you shooing them away? Why are you getting rid of them? فَيُقَالُ لِي, it will be then said to me, إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحْدَثُوا بَعْدَكَ. These people, you do not know what they innovated after you. Innovation. They added things to your religion. They subtracted some things from the religion. They played with the deen of Allah. إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي, Muhammad, you don't know. A couple of benefits that we can take from this is, إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي, Muhammad, you don't know. That the Prophet doesn't know the unseen. Those who say that the Messenger knows the unseen, Allah is telling the Prophet, you don't know that which they have introduced into the religion. These are innovators. They added things to the deen. Brothers, don't add anything to the religion. Because if you do, you will be what? You will be taken away from the fountain. You will be taken away from the fountain. إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحَدَثُوا بَعْدَكَ. These are people introduced something into the religion. Those are the people who are going to, not sinners, innovators. The day of judgment. It's before Jannah. Na'am. That's why I said the hadith bitaqa, some of the riwayat mentioned, he said, Ashadu la ilaha illallah wa ashadu. Ashadu anna Muhammad al-Rasulullah, both of them. The two testimonies. And what does Ashadu anna Muhammad al-Rasulullah mean? Ta'atu fi ma akhbar. Tasdiqu fi, ta'atu fi ma amar. Wa tasdiqu fi ma akhbar. Wa ijtinabu ma naha anhu wa zajar. Wa an la yu'bad Allahu illa bima shara'. Those four things. So following him is from there. You will know what Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah means, right? Yeah. You want me to test you guys? If you don't know what Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah means, then memorize it from here. Ta'atu fi ma amar, wa tasdiqu fi ma akhbar, wa ijtinabu ma naha anhu wa zajar, wa an la yu'bad Allahu illa bima shara'. Those four is what it means. Remember it. Know it. Naam. The author, rahimahullah, Al-Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, he now goes into the issue of عذاب القبر, the punishment of the grave. عذاب القبر is a what? It's something that we have to believe. It's from our aqeedah. The ones who say that we don't take single narrations, خبر الأحد, they reject what? عذاب القبر. On what basis do they reject عذاب القبر? On the issue of, it's a single narration. We don't accept single narrations. That's what they say. Again, at the beginning, what did I say to you? That's a form of rejection of the sunnah. They are rejectors of the sunnah. We have to always remember that. We have to remind them, you're one step away from rejecting the sunnah in totality. And you're very close, brother. Are you with me, brothers? Everyone has this shaitan. Allah says, وَلَا تَتَبِعُوا خُطْوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. Shaitan has a way to misguide people. First of all, you have to reject some of the sunnah, right? And then after that, what happens? You reject it all. You don't just reject the sunnah one time, all of it like that. So the Asha'ira and the Mu'tazila and their likes, they're a step away from the complete, utmost rejection of the sunnah. عَذَابُ الْقَبْرِ, we believe in it. Uthman radiallahu anhu, one day, he cried, حَتَّى يَبُلَّ لِحْيَتُهُ. He cried so much until his beard became full with tears. Full of tears. And then they said to him, Uthman, تُذْكَرُ الْجَنَّةُ وَالنَّارُ. The Jannah is mentioned, the Nar is mentioned. فَلَا تَبْكِي, you don't cry. And then you come to the Qabr and you cry. Why? And then he said, I heard the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, say, إِنَّ الْقَبْرَ أَوَّلُ مَنَازِلِ يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. إِنَّ الْقَبْرَ, the grave is أَوَّلُ مَنَازِلِ الْآخِرَةِ, it's the first stage of the hereafter. فَإِنْ نَجَى مِنْهُ صَاحِبُهُ, if the person makes it in the grave, فَمَا بَعْدَهُ أَيْسَرُ مِنْهُ, everything after that is successful. وَإِنْ لَمْ يَنْجُ مِنْهُ, if the person doesn't make it in the grave, فَمَا بَعْدَهُ أَشَدُ مِنْهُ, everything after it is worse. That's why he cried, Uthman radiallahu anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in another hadith, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّهُ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ, a revelation was sent to me, أَنَّكُمْ تُفْتَنُونَ فِي الْقُبُورِ, that you will be tested in your graves. In another narration, that's so powerful, brothers. The Messenger, he was one day on his riding beast. He was on a mule, and he was riding on it. فَكَادَتْ تُلْقِيهِ, فَحَادَتْ بِي فَكَادَتْ تُلْقِيهِ. It went off the road, and it went fast, and it was about to throw the Messenger, the riding beast. The Prophet was about to fall. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the people, مَنْ أَصْحَابُ هَذِي الْأَقْبُرِ, who are the people of these graves? And they said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَوْمٌ مَاتُوا فِي الشِّرْكِ, it's a people who died upon shirk. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إن هذه الأمة تبتلى في قبورها. This ummah, they will be tested in regards to their grave. إن هذه الأمة, this ummah, they will be tested regarding in the graves. They will be tested in it. فلولا ألا تدافنوا. And if you all were not going to bury your dead, لسألت الله, I would have asked Allah, أما لدعوت الله أن يسمعكم من عذاب القبر الذي أسمع. And I would have asked Allah to allow you to hear the screaming and the wailing of the people in their graves. I would have asked, oh Allah, let them hear it. But the reason why I'm not going to ask Allah that for you is because you all will not bury your dead. You will throw them on the roads. Throw them on top of a tree. Are we all together? And then the animals, they hear it. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to hear it. But we can't hear it. So we believe in Adab al-Qabri. And we all know the long hadith of Hadith Al-Bara ibn Azib. The hadith of who? Al-Bara ibn Azib. The long hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sat down with his companions after they buried their dead. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet took a twig and he started to scratch it on the earth. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, استعيذوا بالله من عذاب القبر. Seek refuge in Allah from the punishment of the grave. استعيذوا بالله من عذاب القبر. استعيذوا بالله من عذاب القبر. He said it three times. And then the Prophet went into the famous hadith of the people who go into their graves, that they are two parties: the criminals, the wrongdoers, the disbelievers, and the believers. May Allah make us from the people of Jannah, and make the punishment أي روضة من رياض الجنة أنت حفرة من حفر النار. نعم.
الإيمان بشفاعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. الإيمان بشفاعة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بقوم يخرجون من النار بعدما اكتروا وصابوا رحمة فيقربهم إلى لهم على باب الجنة كما جاء فليأتوا كيف شاء الله وكما شاء إنما هو الإيمان به والتصديق به.
The author, rahimahullah, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he goes into the shafa'ah, the intercession. Intercession. We believe in the intercession because the ahadiths of the intercession have reached multitude, mutawatir. But like in the hadith of the shafa'ah, it shows us that the intercession is six types. The first one is called Al-Shafa'atul Uzma, the supreme shafa'ah, the greatest shafa'ah. And that's the one when we go to Nabiullah Adam and we say, Adam, you are our father. Allah created you with his hands. وَأَسْجَدَ لَكَ الْمَلَائِكَ. And Allah made the angels prostrate for you, Adam. Today, get us out of the situation that we're in. Ask Allah to get us out of this situation. Nabiullah Adam, he says, no, I have disobeyed Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and I ate from the tree when he told me not to. And the people, they go from that to Nabiullah Nuh. And then from Nabiullah Nuh, he says the same, I can't, it's not me today, leave me. Nafsi, nafsi. Myself, myself. And then the people go to Nabiullah Ibrahim. And they go to Nabiullah and they're Isa. And wahakada. Every prophet is pushing it away from himself. He's saying, I can't. This is not for me. Leave me alone. Nafsi, nafsi. Until they come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Nabiullah Muhammad. And then he says, ana laha, this is mine. This is mine. It's for me. That's the first one. The second one is shafa'atu fi fathi abwab al-jannah. The intercession for the doors of Jannah to be open for its people. The people of Jannah, for the doors of Jannah to be open for them. The third one is the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's intercession for some of the people of Jannah, for their position to be risen more after they've entered Jannah, for them to have a higher station. رَفْعُ دَرَجَاتِهِمْ for their station to be risen higher. Number four, a people who deserve to go to the hellfire, and he will beg Allah tabarak wa ta'ala not to take them to the hellfire, to just take them to Jannah. And the fifth one is his intercession for his uncle Abu Talib, for Allah to lessen for him the punishment of the hellfire. The fifth one, yeah. The fifth one is his uncle Abu Talib, for Allah to reduce the adab for him. And there's a sixth type, but this sixth one is for everyone. It's not specific to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's for the prophets, it's for the righteous people, it's for the angels and others. And that is a group of people who've entered the hellfire. They are in the hellfire. They've made it to the hellfire. They are burning in the hellfire. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says to the people, the people come to Allah and they say, Ya Allah, there are our brothers. Hadith Abi Sa'id al-Khudri. Oh Allah, there are some of our brothers who used to be with us in Jannah, in the dunya. And they used to pray with us. And they used to give zakat with us. And we can't see them in Jannah. What should we do? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, anyone who you've recognized, anyone you know in the hellfire, get them out of the hellfire. And so they go and they take those people out. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, go back, take out anyone whose heart there's a mustard seed of iman. And then they go and they do. And then the angels do the same. And then the righteous people do it. And the prophets do it. And then when they all finish, Allah says, are there more people for you to bring out? And they say, Ya Allah, there is no one else for us to bring out. And then Allah says, شفعت الملائكة وشفعة المؤمنون وشفعة الأنبياء ولم يبقى. And it has, there's nothing remaining, nobody's intercession إلا أرحم الراحمين, except the most merciful. فيضع الله تبارك وتعالى, he grabs, the narration says, he grabs the people with his fist, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he takes them out of the hellfire. And these people have become ashes. They become ashes. They burnt in the hellfire. And then they get taken to a river known as Nahrul Hayat. And they get washed inside there. And then they become, they spring back to life again. And then when they go to the Jannah, they are going to be referred to as Utaqa'ur Rahman. The people Allah freed from the hellfire. That one, the sixth one, is the intercession of everyone. Everyone is going to do it. Lakin, brothers, no one can stay in the hellfire. May Allah make us from the people of Jannah. Na'am. So we believe in those intercession. There are ahadith for each and every one of those. Multitude. Mutawatir. Na'am. This is from the unseen that we need to believe in. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us. This is from the issues which are al-mustaqbalatul ghaybiyya. They are from the unseen that are going to take in the future. We have to believe in it. Because the ahadith that have come regarding it. The hadith regarding Masihud Dajjal is mutawatir. It's not ahad, it's mutawatir. Na'am. Lakin the Prophet said in a hadith, hadith Anas ibn Malik, which is found in Bukhari and Muslim, the Prophet said, مَا مِن نَبِيٍّ بَعَثَهُ اللَّهِ. There is no Prophet Allah sent, إِلَّا أَنذَرَ قَوْمَهُ, except that he warned his people, from who? الْأَعْوَرِ الْكَذَّابِ, the one, the liar, the one-eyed liar. إِنَّهُ أَعْوَر, he's got one eye. وَإِنَّ رَبَّكُمْ لَيْسَ بِأَعْوَرْ, your Lord is not one-eyed. مَكْتُوم بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ كَافِرْ, and in between his two forehead, there's written there kafir. Then the hadith tells us he's got one eye, but he's got another eye, which there's, the eye is not functioning. Are we all together? So he's got two eyes, but one eye is not working. And in between it, kafir is written. This hadith, brothers, from as a young child, when I heard this hadith from my father, Jazakallahu khairan, when I heard it from my father, I questioned, I thought about it. I said to myself, Dajjal is going to come. Dajjal is going to come. And he's going to say to the people, I am ilah. And the people are going to follow him. But he's got one eye missing. Kafir is written. How would the people believe in it? I always wondered, how? But now when I look at social media, it makes every sense to me. Now when I look at the world and the way it's functioning, and the type of people idolize, and the role models that people take, it makes every sense to me. It makes what? It makes every single sense. I understand exactly why Dajjal will come out in a people, this ummah. Are we all together, brothers? It makes sense. Ya ikhwa, Dajjal has one eye. He's got kafir written on it. It's clear. We've already been told he's going to come. Ma'adhalika, he's going to have the largest followers. The largest followers. Today, who are the largest followers in the world that are followed? The righteous people, the scholars, the ulama. Yeah? Are they the largest followers? Yeah? The criminals and the wrongdoers are the ones that are followed. The reason why he's called Dajjal, his whole name is called Dajjal, is because Kathirul Kadhib, he lies a lot. The word Dajjal in the Arabic language, it means a liar. ولذلك the scholars of hadith, if a person is narrating a hadith and he's a liar and he lies about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's always lying, what do they call him? They call him Dajjal. We're going to see that in hadith. When a person lies about the Prophet and he makes up a hadith, they call him a Dajjal. ولذلك الإمام مالك, there was something that happened between him and Muhammad ibn Ishaq. We all know that, right? Sahib al-Sirah. There was a little issue that happened between them two. They were two imams, two great imams. But Imam Malik, he refuted Muhammad ibn Ishaq, and Muhammad ibn Ishaq refuted Imam Malik. Yeah? Muhammad ibn Ishaq said to everybody, bring me the hadiths of Malik and I will deal with it. And so Imam Malik took that to heart and he said, he's a Dajjalun min al-Dajajila. The narrator said, I never knew that the plural of Dajjal is what? Dajajila. That was the first time I heard it. I heard it from Imam Malik. He was the first person to say it for me to know that you make plural out of Dajjal from the Dajajila. So the word Dajjal, so the scholars, they said that this criticism of Imam Malik for Muhammad ibn Ishaq, no one took it. It's just issue that happened between them two. Kalamul akhrani yutwa wa la yurwa. Anyways, Dajjal is a liar. And he will lie and he will fool the people and he will deceive them. And the people will follow him. The people will follow him. So the ahadith of Dajjal is mutawatir. It's multitude narration. It's sahih. Irhamukallah. Also the hadith of Isa ibn Maryam coming down is also mutawatir. Multitude narration. Rather, Isa ibn Maryam coming is in the Quran. Does anyone know? Where it's in the Quran. I promise I'll give a gift to the person who answers this question. Anyone who shows me in the Quran that Isa ibn Maryam is going to come down. It's in the Quran. Huh? Ayah, I want the ayah. May. Huh? Maya. The ayah shows that he was taken up, but I want an ayah that he's going to come and he's going to descend. It's in the Quran. Ya ikhwa, no one in the masjid, with all of the huffaz and everything, no one could bring me one ayah that Isa ibn Maryam is going to come down, yeah? No false thinking, hey, fadl. Firas. وَإِن مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ إِلَّا لَيُؤْمِنَنَّ بِهِ قَبْلَ مَوْتِهِ. That the Nasara, وَإِن مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ, from the people of the scripture is, from this people of the scripture is some of them who are going to believe in Isa ibn Maryam. Believe in him what? When they see him. Isa is going to come down. They're going to see him. The Nasara are going to see him. لَا يُؤْمِنَنَّ بِهِ قَبْلَ مَوْتِهِ. Before Isa dies, they believe in him. That ayah is the first dalil you use of Isa coming down. Are we all together, brothers? Before you go into the ahadith. It's a Surah An-Nisa ayah. 159. Surah An-Nisa, ayah 159. Isa is not dead. We believe he's alive. Allah says, وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُوهُ وَلَكِنْ شُبِّهَ لَهُمْ. In another ayah, Allah says, وَمَا قَتَلُوهُ يَقِينًا بَلْ رَفَعَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ. Isa was not killed, he's still alive. And Allah, Isa will come down. And when Isa ibn Maryam comes down, first thing he's going to do is, he's going to deal with Dajjal. And he's going to kill him in a place called Babul Lud in Sham. Babul Lud in Sham, Isa is going to come and kill him. And when Isa kills him, he's also going to destroy the Christian sign, the Salib. The Prophet said, Yuksiru Salib. He destroys that. They lied about Isa ibn Maryam. They are lying about him. This is not Isa, nor did he die. He destroys. Remember, why is he destroying it? He's a muwahid. He's a prophet of Allah. Are we all together? He can't accept and tolerate this. Sah? He can't accept shirk to be on the earth of Allah. So he destroys it. وَيُقْتُلُ الْخِنْزِيرِ. He gets rid of the swines, the pigs. He kills them. in which they eat. وَيَضَعُ الْجِزْيَةِ And he places the jizya. What does he mean, he places the jizya? He places it off everyone's shoulder. He says, only Islam, nothing else today. There's no such a thing as a jizya. The jizya is not paid. This is just saying, I just want Islam or I'll fight you. Are we all together? So he gives them two options. Are we all together? I said to a Christian one time, this is going to come, and he's the one who's going to force you guys to pay jizya. At least Muhammad gave you a what? A third option, which is jizya. Isa will get rid of that. I have a question now. Is Isa going to come as a prophet? Isa is not a prophet. I'm going to give you guys two options. Is Isa a prophet or is he a companion? Isa is coming in down in what form? When he comes to this, is he a prophet from Allah? Okay, are you, any other answer? He is or he isn't, that's all I want. So he's not a prophet, hey? Yeah?
He is a prophet, but he will be following
the legislation of Nabi Muhammad, hey? Yeah? He's a prophet, Anna? So if he's following Nabi Muhammad, Nabi Muhammad used to take jizya. How comes he's not taking jizya? He's not following the Prophet's legislation. The Quran mentions that there's jizya that's taken. Sah? Hey, why is Isa taking no jizya? Yeah? The Prophet gave him the legislation already in advance. He has the legislation here right now. The Prophet said he's not going to take the jizya, meaning he should not take the jizya. Are we all together, brothers? So Nabila Isa, when he comes, he's going to be from the followers of this deen. He's not coming with his own legislation. And the fact that he's not taking the jizya, it's not like we come and then Isa does it and we don't know how he did this. We already know that the Prophet told us that he's going to do that. So it's prescribed for him. Are we all together, brothers? There's a legislation that was prescribed for him over here. And na'am. And there's a risala written by Shaykh Al-Albani rahimahullah where he compiled between the two issues that I just mentioned. All of the entire narrations of Dajjal and all of the hadiths of Isa ibn Maryam coming down, Shaykh Al-Albani compiled it in one risala. And he called it Qissa. Qissatul Masih al-Dajjal. And it means all of the riwayat in an amazing manner. I don't think anyone's done it like him. I don't know the name, but you will find it. If you just say Albani's hadith book on Isa ibn Maryam, Dajjal is only one. It's amazing. Buy it. Especially nowadays, people questioning these two, you have to buy that book. You have to read all of those narrations. Mm-hmm. Naam. The iman increases and it decreases. Do we believe that? Yeah. Iman increases and it? Hey, yeah. The iman increases and it what? Hey, what's the evidence that the iman increases? Ilyas, what's the evidence that the iman increases? How did the Prophet say it? Hey, who knows, yeah? I want the hadith. Who can narrate the hadith for me? Huh? Narrate in Arabic. In Arabic. Hayy fadl. Al-Imanu? That's not the statement of the Prophet, that's the statement of the scholars. Marra'a minkum mukallab. What is that? Hayy. That's the evidence that the hadith is the weakest of iman. Okay, that's the evidence that the iman decreases. Okay, I want evidence the hadith increases. ayah, hadith, something. Hey, for us. فخشهم فزادهم فزادهم إيمانا نعم صحيح إنما المؤمنون الذين آمنوا إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم وإذا تليت عليهم آياته إيش آياته زادتهم إيمانا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون إيمان increases. Brothers, I beg you, any issue you believe in, find your دليل. Don't just say yes, that's yes. The scholars, they said this and this is what said. دليل. What's your دليل for this? Learn the ayah, learn the hadith. You have to, especially these issues of aqidah related issues. It has to be on your tongue. The iman is qawl and amal. Iman is speech and action. Hey, what's the evidence? Today I'm going to question. Hey, what's the evidence that iman is qawl and amal? Everyone's putting his head down, start looking at his book now. Hey, what's the evidence that iman is qawl and amal? Hey, yeah. الإيمان بضع وسبعون شعبة هيا أعلاها قول لا إله إلا الله هيا وأدناها إماطة الأذى عن الطريق هيا والحياة شعبة من الإيمان أما الحياة من الإيمان صح That's enough for me. This hadith mentioned, the Prophet said that إيمان is how many branches? الإيمان بضع وسبعون شعبة. Another narration said بضع وستون شعبة. Two narrations. One says 60 some odd numbers, and the other one says 670 odd numbers. The highest of it is what? Qawlu la ilaha illallah. La ilaha is what? Qawl. Speech. Wa adnaha. The lowest of iman is what? Huh? Taking harm from the earth. And then what did the Prophet say? Wal haya'u min al iman. Let's stand over this hadith. This hadith is powerful. Nabiullah Muhammad was teaching us something more than what we can just see. You know what he was teaching us? He was teaching us that the iman is divided into three. Are you all paying attention, brothers? Okay, let's go again. Iman is how many branches? 73 branches. Okay, what's the highest? Tawheed, la ilaha illallah, right? La ilaha illallah is the foundation of your iman. Without it, there is no iman. So write this down, everybody. Aslul iman. The foundation of iman. Aslul iman. The foundation of iman. That's what? La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah represents the asl of iman. That's the first thing that the Prophet was showing us in the hadith. Hayyeh. What was the second thing that the Prophet mentioned? Haya, right? Shyness. I want to put it in order. Shyness, right? Did the Prophet not mention shyness? Did he not say shyness is from iman? That is a wajibul iman. Write that down. Wajibul iman. Ama kamaluhu al-wajib. That's it's an obligation of iman. Without it, iman will exist. But it's highly deficient. Are we all together? The third that the Prophet mentioned was what? Imatatul adha anit tariq, taking harm from the earth. That's the third type of iman. What is it? It is mustahab, recommended iman. The third type is the recommended iman. Kamaluhul mustahab. So let's say it one more time. The first one was aslul iman, the foundation of iman, which was la ilaha illallah. The second one was haya, shyness, which is kamaluhul wajib. It's the obligatory things that you need to come within the religion. The obligatory things that kamaluhul wajib. The third one was what? The third one is kamaluhul mustahab. It's like your body. If somebody stabs you in the heart, what will happen to you? You'll die. That's the asal. Foundation for your existence. Okay. What about if somebody chopped your hand off? You still live, but you're deficient. That's kamaluhul wajib. What about if you lost your hair? If you lost your hair, yeah? You just lose your beauty. or the completeness. Huh? Are we all together, brothers? Am I making sense now? Those three are the Iman. Just like the body, the Iman is like that. Are we all together, brothers? If you lose the asal of your Iman, you're not a Muslim anymore. You leave the fold of Islam. The scholars, they all agree part of asul Iman is La ilaha illallah. There's no difference of opinion on that. Are we all together, brothers? Lakin, is there anything else that needs to be added into asulul Iman? Some scholars, they put the salah in there, and some people, they put the salah in the what? The wajib. Does that make sense? If you put in the asal, meaning you're not a Muslim. Some scholars are, no, take it to the kamalul wajib. You're a Muslim, but you're very deficient. It's like a person who's lost an arm, or one leg is missing. Are we all together, brothers? Even that though they differ, which one falls under these three, there are differences, but they don't differ on these three branches. But which one it goes where is differed upon. Am I making sense here? All of it's taken from that hadith, al-imanu bid'un wa sab'una shu'ba, a'laha qawlu la ilaha illallah, wa adnaha imatatu al-adha anil tariq, wal haya'u shu'batu min al-iman. Am I making sense? Again, one more time. Those three that I just mentioned, they are called, those three just I mentioned, it's called shu'abul iman. Shu'ab, branches of iman. Those three I just mentioned, it's called shu'abul iman, the branches of al-iman. But what are the pillars of al-iman? Qawl and amal. Qawl and amal are the pillars of al-iman, arkanul iman. What are they? Qawl and amal. They are pillars. These two are pillars. Qawl means speech, and amal means what? Action. They're both pillars. Here, there are three groups. There are how many groups? Three groups. The first group are the Khawarij. I want you to all understand the issue of the Khawarij and Ahlul Sunnah. The Khawarij, for them, how many branches of Iman did I say there were? Yeah? Respond quickly, brothers. How many branches of Iman did I mention? Three. What was the first one? Asrul Iman. Second one was what? Kamalul Wajib. The third one was what? This three branches, Ahlul Sunnah believe in it. The Khawarij, all of the Iman is an Asal. Please ponder, this is, you have to really understand. To the Khawarij, the whole religion, everything in it is Asal, foundation. So based on, to them, if everything is an Asal, what are they going to do to everybody who doesn't come with Asal? Are you with me, brothers? What do they do to them? Expel them out of the religion. Are you with me, brothers? The Murji'ah, to them, everything of the Iman is a sub-branch. It's mustahab, it's recommended. There's no asal, or there is no wajib. All of it's recommended. It's mustahabbat. Diametrically opposite, Ahlul Sunnah are the only ones who believe in those three. Anyone who believes in those three, he enters the view of Ahlul Sunnah. He is from the mu'taqad of Ahlul Sunnah. Even if he differs on which one enters the asal and which one goes into the fara' and which one goes, are you with me, brothers? As long as he believes these three branches are present. Okay, one more time. How many pillars are there of Iman? How many pillars of Iman are there? Two. What were they? Qawl and Amal. What's Qawl? Speech. Amal is what? Action. The speech is divided into two. The speech, according to Ahlul Sunnah, is two. Speech is two. The speech of the tongue. qawlul lisan, the speech of the tongue. The speech of the tongue. Qawlul lisan. What's an example of qawlul lisan? The speech of the tongue. An-nutq bi-shahadatayn, the testimony of la ilaha illallah. Are we all together, brothers? Is everybody with me? Okay, hold on to that information for me. I don't want to do information overload. From the shu'abul iman, qawlul lisan, what does it fall under? Asal or wajib or mustahab? Nutq bi shahadatayn, the pronunciation of la ilaha illallah for a person to enter Islam, what does it become? Asal. So right under that you write asal, foundation. Qawlul lisan is asal for you. Without it, there's no iman. Are we all together, brothers? The second type of qawl, the second type of speech, which is what? Qawlul qalbi. Qawlul qalbi. It's the speech of the heart. The speech of the heart is al-inqiyad, to submit. It's what? Ama al-iqrar. Both ways. Even that though Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah in Kitab al-Iman, he avoids the term al-iqrar. He avoids it. He prefers the word al-inqiyad. And I won't go into why. Okay? Okay. Good. Al-inqiyad, what does it mean? Submission. I mentioned it, right? Submission. Okay. Is that a asal from the shu'ab al-iman? Or is it wajib? Or is it mustahab? It's an asal. Right under it, asal, foundation. When a person says la ilaha illallah from his tongue, his heart has to submit with it. Are we all together? It's a foundation. Stop here, brothers. Stop here. So you're saying, and this is tricky because these masail are very detailed and it's fine-tuned that it can cause a problem if you mix everything up. When I said it's a asal, does it mean that your Islam is not accepted from you unless you come with nutq bi shahadatayn, the pronunciation of the shahadatayn, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu Muhammadur Rasulullah, and you then affirm it in your heart? If you don't come with both, we're not going to accept it from you. Is that what we say? No. For us, he can be lying if he wants to. We will still take it from him. Us, we can only judge on the first one, which is if he says to us, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu Muhammadur Rasulullah, even in the most awkward situations, like what happened to Usama ibn Zaydin. Usama was in the battlefield. Sah? Usama's fighting with the man. And the man is fighting back with Usama. And as Usama is about to strike him, the man goes, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu Muhammadur Rasulullah. This situation does not look like al-inqiyad or al-iqrar. Doesn't seem to be there. Are we all together, brothers? It doesn't seem to be there. Wallahi, brothers, pay attention. It's very important. It doesn't seem to be there. But can there be a chance that it could be real? We live on that 0.0001%. And we believe, we take that. In case there could have been real. Are we all together, brothers? And we take his la ilaha illallah for. Are you there, brothers? We will accept it. We'll say, okay, Islam is accepted. Lakin, when I said it was a asal, I mean the day of judgment, it won't be accepted from him. Unless it comes with both. Are we all together? So we distinguish here between umur al-dunya wa umur al-akhirah. The dunya and the hereafter. The dunya, we will accept la ilaha illallah from anybody who says it to us. Even if the context and the situation doesn't look out of proportion to us, we will take it because we were commanded to judge the people by what? By what they say. Are we all together? Allah said in the ayah, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَنْ أَلْقَى إِلَيْكُمُ السَّلَامَةِ لست مؤمنا. Don't say to those people who say assalamu alaikum to you, don't say to them, you're not Muslims. Take it from them. Take what's apparent. Are we all together, brothers? Am I making sense here? Next, now we finish the speech. Speech of the tongue and the speech of the? Both of them are what? Asal. I now want to stop here and I want to explain groups that went against Ahlul Sunnah. Okay. There's a group known as the Murji'ah. Have you heard of them? If you haven't, it's the first time to hear of them. The Murji'ah, there are two groups of the Murji'ah. There are many groups, but I'm trying to summarize it for you to make it easy for you. There's a group of the Murji'ah that said the only thing that is an asal is the utterance of La ilaha illallah. They said what's in your heart is not an asal. They are called Ghulatul Murji'ah, the extreme Murji'ah. We just mentioned that the speech of the tongue and the speech of the heart, both of them are foundation. Did I not say that? They said, no, the speech of the tongue is enough. That's a foundation. The speech of the heart is not an asal. And they are called the extreme Murji'ah. They are a deviated group. And they said that's enough for a person's Islam. So according to them, the munafiqeen are what? Muslims. Because the munafiqeen, do they not say La ilaha illallah? Oh, they say it all day. They say it all day. These are the extreme Murji'ah, which are the Jahmiyyah. There's another group of the Murji'ah, the second ones. What do they say? They said the two that I just mentioned, Qawlul Qalb and the Qawlul Lisan, they are both asal, but the action is not part of Iman. This is enough. Say it with your tongue, believe in your heart, it's khalas, nothing else. The actions is not a pillar of Iman. They stopped here. They don't want to move on. Because I'm going to move on right now, sah? I'm going to move on to actions. The other group of the Murji'ah, they stopped here. And they said both of them are what? Asal. Qawlul Qalbi and Qawlul Lisan. That's it. As for the amal, the action, which is the second pillar of Iman. Brothers, are you all with me or am I just talking to myself? You want me to repeat it? Shall I repeat myself? I'm going to come to it. I'm going to come to what they know as mustahab. Okay, I'm going to come to it. The Murji'ah are two groups. There are many more, but as you go on, you start learning another group came in. The Murji'ah, when it comes to the speech, they believe the person has to say it. Are we all together, brothers? On his tongue. And what did I say they have to do also? One group, what did they say? He just has to say it with his tongue and he doesn't have to affirm it in his heart. No problem. According to them, who's a believer? The munafiqeen. Another group said, that's a very bad statement of yours. We believe what? Qawlul lisan and qawlul, both of them to us is a foundation. Are we all together? They made it both an asal. Are we all together, brothers? That's as far as the Murji'ah stopped. Are we all together, brothers? None of them, all the groups of the Murji'ah, none of them came into the actions. They stopped there and that's where they believed. Now we go into the second one. Which is what? The second pillar. What's it called? Actions. Actions are two types. The actions are how many types? Two types. Qa'amalul qalbi, the action of the heart. The action of the heart. The first one is amalul qalbi, the action of the heart. And in there what falls? Al-hubbu, wal-raja, wal-khawfu, wal-raghba, wal-rahba, wal-inaba. Loving Allah, coming with sincerity, fearing Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, tawakkul in Allah azza wa jalla. All of them are actions of the heart. Now, what's the difference between the speech of the heart and the action of the heart? I won't go into that now. Are we all together, brothers? I won't, because it's too technical for you. All of those are what? All of them are foundation. عمل القلب is an asal. From the three shu'ab of iman, asal, foundation. عمل القلب, loving Allah is a foundation. Hoping in Allah is foundation. All of these are what? Sincerity for Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is a foundation. عمل القلب is a what? It's a foundation. Good. Now we come into the second type of action, which is action of the limbs. عَمَلُ الْجَوَارِحِ, the actions of the your limbs. This is salah, zakah, sawm, hajj. Are we all together, brothers? The action of the heart, is it asal or is it if you say that the action of the heart is an asal, you fall into the view of the khawarij. Yay. Meaning every actions of the limbs is a foundation. If anybody leaves, he's a disbeliever. So if the person doesn't pay zakat, is he a disbeliever? No, I'm talking about actions of, not actions of the heart. Did I say actions of the heart? I mean action of the limbs. Action of the limbs. Sorry, correction. Actions of the heart, now all of them are foundations. Are we all together? What about the actions of the limbs? Are they all foundation? So is it as a sub-branch? Is it a wajib? Are you all with me, Lakin? Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah, including the author of this book. Who is the author of this book? Imam Ahmed. Imam Ahmed held five views in this issue. Please listen to it. How many views did he hold when it came to the actions of the limbs? Imam Ahmed believed the actions of the limbs. He believed, first view, that the actions of the limbs, if a person leaves the salah, he's a kafir. That's the only foundation to Ahmed ibn Hanbal according to one view. The only foundation of the actions of the limbs according to Imam Ahmed was what? Salah only. Another view of his is what? Salah and zakat. Another view of his is what? Salah, zakat and sawm. Another view of his is what? Salah, zakat, sawm and hajj. How many views do you have here? Four views, right? And another view of his is that none of the actions of the limbs are a foundation. The only thing is La ilaha illallah, which is amalul qalbi and qawlul qalbi and qawlul lisan is asal. And none of the actions of the limbs are a asal, according to Imam Ahmed. Five views. Am I making sense here? Shall I repeat myself or do you guys get it? It's too technical, huh? Yeah? Is it too technical what I said? Shall I repeat it one more time? When it comes to the actions of the limb, I'm going to stop at this point, inshallah ta'ala. When it comes to the action of the limb, Al-Imam Ahmed, five views. The first view is salah. That's it. If you leave the salah, you're kafir. Another view of Al-Imam Ahmed, salah and zakat. If you leave zakat, you're kafir as well. Al-Imam Ahmed believed another view, fasting as well. Another view, zakat as well. Those are four views, right? Those four in Arabic, they're known as mabani al-arba'ah. In Aqidah books, if you come across mabani al-arba'ah, the four pillars. According to Ahlul Sunnah, if somebody makes takfir on these four, it's a view from the views of Ahlul Sunnah, but it's weak. It's a weak view, but it's a view of Ahlul Sunnah. It's not the belief of the Khawarij. But it's a weak view. Ahmed then had a fifth view, which was what? None of the actions of the limb is a what? It's an asal. Are we all together, brothers? That was a fifth view of Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah ta'ala. Ala kulli hal, the strongest opinion is, the only thing that is a foundation in the actions of the limbs is a what? Salah. That's the strongest opinion. I ask you guys a question now. I want you to think, who's of the opinion that leaving the salah is disbelief? There's two views of Ahlul Sunnah. Who's of the opinion that leaving the salah is disbelief? Put your hand up. Who is of the opinion that it's not disbelief? Put your hand up. Don't worry. Honesty is the best policy. Okay. Those people who believe leaving the salah is not kufr akbar, what is the foundation of actions of the limbs? For them, the action of the limbs, those of you who said that leaving the salah is not disbelief, then according to you, nothing from the actions of the limb is a what? Asal. So the action of the limb is not a asal. Yeah? Please listen to what I'm saying. Are you with me? So does that mean that if you don't come with actions of the limbs in totality, you're still a Muslim? Have you guys heard of these issues of irja being thrown at some people because of this issue? Sheikh Albani being accused of irja. Have you heard of it? It's because of this issue. If you leave the salah, you are left with believing that the actions of the limbs, none of it is what? Food for thought, inshaAllah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, a shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.